doing non-cardiac surgery. 1/8 of the patients die within 30 days of major surgeries. The term postoperative pulmonary complications consists of complications affecting the respiratory system after surgery and anesthesia. Postoperative respiratory failure is the most common pulmonary complication. I'll name some of the complications and the causes and clinical features and investigations pertaining to the complications. So we have respiratory infection, respiratory failure, pulmonary effusion, pneumothorax, bronchospasm, atelectasis, aspiration pneumonia, ARDS, pulmonary edema, DVT, and pulmonary embolism. Respiratory infections, most commonly pneumonia. Some of the causes could be pre-existing and recently treated pneumonia, and sometimes as COVID is recently present, it could be associated with COVID also. And during a GA, if the ED tube is not sterile, and if we use unsterile techniques, that could also be one of the reasons. Clinical features would be like fever, temperature more than 38 degrees Celsius, new onset of cough, dyspnea, tachypnea, sputum production, bronchial breath sounds, WBC count more than 12 lakhs, and new infiltrations on chest X-ray. Respiratory failure. Respiratory failure can be because of hypoventilation. The drugs which we give in anesthesia can cause CNS depression and narcotic overdose. Then disorders of the muscular system, which is the respiratory muscle and chest wall weakness, which are seen in Guillain-Barré syndrome and myasthenia gravis. And upper and lower airway obstruction, which is seen in COPD and acute severe bronchial asthma. And another cause of respiratory failure is pulmonary edema. The clinical features will be tachypnea, dyspnea, cyanosis. And on chest X-ray, you will see bilateral infiltrations. On auscultation, if you have pulmonary edema, you can see close breaths. If it's an asthma, you will hear wheeze. And if it is a narcotic overdose, you will have pinpoint pupils. Pleural effusion, the cause would be most commonly, it could be a pre-existing pleural effusion. Other causes could be pneumonia, which is associated with pleural effusion, cardiac failure, nephrotic syndrome, liver failure, mixed edema. The clinical features, investigations would be dyspnea, cough, chest pain, decreased breath sounds, dullness on percussion. On chest X-ray, you will see blunting of costophrenic angle, displacement of adjacent anatomic structure, loss of the sharp stellate of ipsilateral hemidiaphragm in the upright position. The fourth complication would be pneumothorax. Some of the causes are barotrauma, or it's seen when we give high PEEP during surgery, accidental puncture during central venous catheterization. The clinical features would be acute pleuritic chest pain, dyspnea, absent breath sounds. On percussion, you will have hyper-resonant sound. Chest X-ray, absent lung markings, ipsilateral collapsed lung, and it will be associated with a mediastinal shift. Bronchospasm, it will be history of bronchial asthma, chronic smoking, recent respiratory tract infection, or exacerbation of COPD. The clinical features and investigations would be newly detected respiratory wheeze, which is treated with bronchodilators, tachypnea, dyspnea. Atelectasis, basal atelectasis seen after upper abdominal and thoracic surgery and during general anesthesia. Elderly patients, it depends even on the duration of surgery. If there's a prolonged surgery, the chances of atelectasis are more. Pre-existing lung or neuromuscular disease, and post-operative pain. The clinical features would be tachypnea, dyspnea, increase in the heart rate, reduced air entry, dullness on percussion. On chest X-ray, there will be displacement of the interlobular fissures, crowding of pulmonary vessels, elevation of diaphragm, and compensatory hyperexpansion. Aspiration pneumonitis, commonly seen with GERD, pregnancy, diabetes mellitus, renal failure, head trauma. The clinical features and investigations would be acute lung injury after inhalation of regurgitated gastric contents. You'll have tachypnea, dyspnea, wheeze. Chest X-ray, you will have infiltrates in the dependent region. posterior basal segment of the lower lobe and posterior segment of the upper lobe. ARDS causes would be pneumonia, aspiration of gastric contents, air or fat embolism, sepsis, transfusion related acute lung injury, cardiopulmonary bypass. Clinical features: dyspnea, tachypnea, tachycardia. All of these features will be acute onset in less than 1 week. Bilateral crepitations, chest X-rays, you will have bilateral opacities on lung fields. And it can be classified as mild, moderate, severe when the PaO2 to FiO2 ratio is less than 300 for mild, less than 200 for moderate, and less than 100 for severe. Pulmonary edema, the cause could be fluid overload, cardiac failure, massive blood transfusions during surgery, acid aspiration, negative pressure, pulmonary edema. The clinical features would be dyspnea, pink, frothy, sputum, cough. On auscultation, you will have post crepitations, chest X-ray, increased pulmonary veins, curly B lines. Another complication is DVT and pulmonary embolism, which is commonly seen in post-op, mainly pertaining to obesity, orthopedic procedures when they have cases of polytrauma, prolonged immobilization. They'll have chest pain, shortness of breath, increased D-dimer, and can be confirmed by CT pulmonary angiogram. Now coming to the risk factors can be divided into patient-related and procedure-related. Both of these has modifiable and non-modifiable. So patient-related non-modifiable factors would be age, male sex, elderly, ASA more than 3, acute respiratory infection within 1 month, impaired cognition or impaired sensorium, cerebrovascular accident, malignancy, long-term steroid use, prolonged hospital stay. Modifiable could be smoking. They can improv or post-op, they can have cough, bronchospasm, laryngospasm, aspiration, and hypoxia. COPD would be bronchospasm, pneumonia, prolonged intubation. Recent respiratory tract infection can have a reactive airway, bronchospasm, laryngospasm, increased airway resistance. Obstructive sleep apnea, hypoxia, aspiration, pneumonia, tracheal intubation, respiratory and cardiac failure. Other modifiable factors are hypertension, chronic liver failure, sepsis, shock, and renal failure. Procedure related, the non-modifiable factors are the type of surgery: upper abdominal surgery, thoracic surgery, neurosurgery, head and neck, and vascular surgeries. Emergency surgery versus an elective. Duration of the procedure, if it is more than 2 hours, or reoperation. Modifiable would be mechanical ventilation strategies, GA versus a regional, and neostigmine. Intraoperative risk factors, which can be during a GA, the FRC is reduced by 15 to 20%. So there's altered distension during the intermittent positive pressure ventilation, and there'll be VQ mismatch. Changes to respiratory system occur on induction of general anesthesia due to muscle function are altered. It takes at least 6 weeks to return to pre-op after a major surgery. Diminished response to hypoxia and hypercapnia, which causes hypoventilation. In spontaneously ventilating patients, the closing capacity approaches the FRC and the small airways collapse. Satellite cases are seen in the dependent region of the lung region, and there are increased chance of atelectasis cases when we give a higher FiO2. Post-operatively, pain limits the respiratory function and causes splinting of diaphragm, which reduces the FRC by the capacity for causing atelectasis cases and collapse. Effects of anesthesia and opioids: inhibit cough, impair respiratory tract ciliary activity, and are prone for respiratory infection and respiratory depression. Atelectasis, displaced diaphragm due to positioning, airway closure when FRC is less than the closing volume. Residual effects of neuromuscular blocking drugs, which impairs respiratory function when the TORF ratio is less than 0.9, reduce FRC and peak expiratory flow rate. Impaired activity of genioglossus, which causes airway obstruction, and there can be increased resistance. There's abnormal coordination between the pharyngeal and upper esophageal muscles, and that increases the risk of aspiration. Hypoxia is common due to airway obstruction, exacerbated by hypercapnia and combined with sedation from anesthetic and narcotic drugs, and leads to central respiratory depression. Now we'll see the strategies to reduce post-operative pulmonary complications. Way of identification of the problem and its treatment in case of patient has COPD, optimization with inhaled beta 2 agonists and anticholinergics, corticosteroids, systemic and inhaled antibiotics in case they have any pneumonia, giving nebulization antibiotics prior and treating the cause. If a patient is a smoker, early cessation of smoking. There are surgical and anesthetic strategies to reduce the complications. Surgical would be to minimal invasive surgeries to reduce postoperative pulmonary complications, especially in the obese patients. Selective use of NG tube. Anesthetic could be postoperative pulmonary complications can be reduced by lung protective modes of mechanical ventilation. Ventilator-associated lung injury is seen in alveolar over-distension, which is also known as volutroma, and increase in transpulmonary pressure, barotrauma. Basal atelectasis is seen due to anesthesia and surgical causes. So the lung protective ventilation would be lower tidal volume, around 6 to 8 ml per kg, deep of 6 to 8 cm of water, and recruitment maneuvers, giving a CPAP 30 cm of water for 30 seconds every 30 minutes when a patient is under GA. Should be careful of the amount of neostigmine given. If it's given in larger doses to recover a patient from deep anesthesia, that could be one of the complications. Intraoperative neuraxial blockade, consideration of neuraxial blockade, goal-directed fluid therapy. Postoperative, make sure effective analgesia so that the patient won't have pain and doesn't predispose to atelectasis. Early mobilization, chest physiotherapy, and lung expansion techniques.
Have we completed?
Yes, sir.
Good. You know, when you go for a marriage or a function, there are two types of food serving habits are there. Have you heard of that? One is buffet type, another is lay the plate or the leaf and serve them in an orderly fashion. And buffet, you have a lot of varieties. You can pick and choose whatever you want at random and eat according to your own whims and fancies. Whereas in the serving system, they will lay a leaf or a plate and then everything will come one by one. And you have to ask for extra helping. Okay? So your presentation is like a buffet system. You have plenty of material, but it has to be given in an orderly fashion. Okay? Can I see your face? I have not seen your face at all. Your video is working?
Yes, sir.
Can you just open your video and show me your face? Okay. You are a primary candidate or a post-DA?
MD, sir.
MD, general MD. From?
Balaji Medical College. Balaji Medical College.
Balaji. Okay. Right. Good. So you have... See, when you go through your presentation, you will know that you were first describing the various types of complications, then you are going to the risk factor, then you are coming back again to some complications, again you are going back to some treatment part of it. So it's all jumbled up, but you have all the points you have covered, but you have to organize yourself into a proper presentation. Okay. Did you give any description or definition about what is the postoperative pulmonary complications first? Did you say how soon after a surgery it should happen? Is there any time limit like that?
Around 24 to 48 hours after surgery.
48 to 72 hours. No, up to 3 days if after a surgery. And it should be a new onset one. See, pleural effusion you mentioned. Can pleural effusion develop within 24 to 48 hours after surgery?
Pre-existing.
Very, very rare, isn't it? Whereas a pneumothorax can develop, a hemothorax can develop if it is a lung surgery or abdominal surgery near the diaphragm. Okay. So first thing is you must be able to define what is a postoperative pulmonary complications. Second thing is, what are the entities which come under the postoperative pulmonary complications that you can enumerate one by one. And then third thing is, you must say what are the risk factors or who are all the patients who are likely to develop this problem. And then the fourth one is you have to go for description of each and every problem. And finally, what is the treatment, general treatment and individual treatment. So if you organize your points like that, it will be a better presentation than starting with atelectasis, respiratory infection, pneumonia and like that, and then going to risk factors and then coming back to a treatment like the deep breathing and incentive spirometry and all these things. Okay, so that will be a matter more. So I would like to show you a PPT as to how you can do that.
Sir, written it as notes.
Are you able to see that?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Okay, okay, okay. Is it becoming a full screen now?
Yes, it's.
Okay, so this is the question that you have been asked. Actually, the full question is post-operative pulmonary complications after non-cardiac surgery. Okay, so first what we will define is respiratory complications that occur within 48 to 72 hours of following surgery. They come under the category of post-operative pulmonary complications. And the conditions affecting the respiratory tract can adversely influence the clinical course of the patient. That is very important. You can have just a sore throat, okay? And after one or two garglings, it may go off. That is not a serious pulmonary complications, but it should affect the respiratory tract in such a way that it is going to delay the discharge or make the patient stay in the hospital for a few more days or produce some fever, produce some discomfort. So it should affect the course of the patient's treatment. That is the second criteria to say that it is a pulmonary complication. And third one is any pulmonary abnormality occurring in the post-operative period that produces identifiable dysfunction that is clinically significant and adversely affects the clinical course again. So these are the three things by which you can say a particular complication belongs to the category of post-operative pulmonary complication. There is a wide spectrum of pulmonary complications which are compiled as follows. The most commonest is the atelectasis, pneumonia, bronchitis, bronchospasm, exacerbation, pulmonary collapse, respiratory failure requiring ventilatory support, acute lung injury, various types, all these things are categorized under post-operative complications. Now, you can also classify them in this order, taking it as respiratory failure, atelectasis, acute lung injury, pneumonia, pneumothorax, pneumonitis, exacerbation of COPD and all these things. Now, for those who want to easily remember things, you take the first letter from all these things. What do you get? What word do you get? You don't want to spell that. You don't want to pronounce that. It comes as rape, which is a very common complaint nowadays. So if you remember that mnemonic, first is respiratory failure, in which you can also include respiratory infection. Okay. And atelectasis, acute lung injury, pneumonia, pneumothorax, pneumonitis, exacerbation. And lastly, a controversial thing called embolism. Pulmonary embolism belongs to actually cardiovascular problem, but because it happens in the lung, some people include that into the respiratory complications also. So by this method, you can easily remember all these points. And these are all the first things that you write. Then next thing is you have to say who are all the patients who are under the risk for all these problems. So it can be patient related and procedure related, as you rightly said. And the patient related, it depends on the age, the positive cough test, which has been there previously. That is, if you ask the patient to cough once, it leads to recurrent coughing. So that indicates that there is some irritability in the respiratory tract. And that is what is called the positive cough test. And if he's a smoker, there is a higher incidence of complication. If he has already established COPD, that is another risk factor. If he's a known asthmatic, if he's obese patient, if his general nutrition is not good, and if he suffers from OSA. These are all the factors which will lead to the possibility of postoperative pulmonary complications. Similarly, the procedure related factors, you can include duration of surgery, type of anesthesia, site of surgery, site and type, that is laparoscopy or open surgery, whether it is emergency or elective, any blood transfusion given, any nasogastric tube inserted, any mechanical ventilation required in the postoperative period, all these things will lead to the possibility of postoperative pulmonary complications. Now, postoperative hypoxemia is the most commonest. Before you talk about atelectasis, pneumonitis, and all these things, postoperative hypoxemia is the most commonest pulmonary complication. There are many reasons why patients can develop this problem, isn't it? All of you know that. This can be because of the residual effect of the anesthetic agents, patient not ventilating properly, which is the most commonest thing. Second is, it can be due to airway obstruction. Third is, they can be reduced carbon dioxide responsive even when they are hyperventilating, as in, which are all the patients who will hyperventilate even if they accumulate CO2. Can you give me one example, Tanya? Which patient is likely to not respond to CO2 accumulation and quietly slip into what is called hypercarbic coma?
COPD.
Endocrine gland problem. Hypothyroid patients, okay? They are more sensitive to opioids as well as they are not responsive to carbon dioxide stimulation. And any residual neuromuscular blocking agent, splinting of the diaphragm due to pain, all these things will lead to, this is a very simple treatable cause and a problem, but hypoxemia is allowed to continue, that may lead to a lot of complications. And as a result of pain, if the patient is not coughing properly, they can retain secretion and that may lead to chest infection. And there is also a spinal reflex inhibition of the phrenic nerve, which reduces the breathing ability, and all these things lead to atelectasis. So this is more or less like a pathophysiology of the entire complication that can produce. And the first and foremost we will take is the atelectasis. And atelectasis, there are three types of atelectasis. One is called the compressive atelectasis, which happens because of the intraoperative factors like general anesthesia, supine position, neuromuscular blockade, and increased intra-abdominal pressure preventing the diaphragmatic movement, and adrenaline position again increasing the intra-abdominal pressure. All these things splint the diaphragm. So the basal portions, especially the basal portions of the lung, they develop atelectasis even in the intraoperative period itself. If you are not taking proper care or you adjust your ventilator settings for that. So the compressive atelectasis starts intraoperatively and progresses to the postoperative period. That is a very important point all of us must remember. And the most affected part is the basal segments. And the degree of atelectasis can be more in especially obese patients. The second category is what is called absorption atelectasis. So you, when you started presenting, you said atelectasis, the first type, the compression. After discussion of some other points, then you later on said giving 100% oxygen can lead to absorption atelectasis. On the contrary, if you organize them in the same heading, it will be much more easier. So the greater the FAA2, faster the collapse. And pre-oxygenation before induction and oxygenation with 100% oxygen at the end of the surgery and endotracheal suctioning. Nowadays, we don't advocate people to pass the suction catheter into the endotracheal tube at all. But in some cases, when you feel there are some blockages and the patient's cough is wet, and you put a suction into the endotracheal tube, you must make sure that you again connect the patient to the anesthetic circuit and at least bag and expand the lung before taking out the tube. So just applying the suction, clearing the secretion, and then just pulling out the tube is a very wrong method of extubation, which will again lead to this atelectasis. This direct negative pressure will cause the collapse. The third reason is the for the atelectasis, the loss of surfactant. And this loss of surfactant can happen in the any time in the perioperative period. So when the surfactant is not there, alveoli will collapse. The surfactant helps to enlarge the alveoli, and chronic alcohol abuse reduces the surfactant. So if a patient has got a history of chronic alcoholism, they are likely to develop this problem. So this absence of surfactant prevents the collapsed alveoli from reopening. And if the alveoli don't open, surfactant does not work again. So whatever little surfactant is there, that may not work. So it becomes a vicious cycle. So atelectasis impedes surfactant function, making the lung prone to collapse even after reopening. This becomes a vicious cycle, like loss of surfactant causing atelectasis and atelectasis leading to decreased function of the surfactant. Okay. So three types of atelectasis you have to remember. One is the compressive atelectasis. Second is the absorption atelectasis. Third is the loss of surfactant atelectasis. Any of these types can happen, and the postoperative measures to prevent. Intraoperatively, you should use good amount of ventilation, correct tidal volume, correct minute ventilation, and some amount of PEEP will always help in preventing the atelectasis forming intraoperatively. And postoperatively, when it happens, you must have good analgesia for the patient to take a deep breath. Incentive spirometry should be given to increase the lung volume by increased force of inspiration. Deep breath expiration should be taken. So patient should at least hold the breath for 3 to 5 seconds, which will significantly increase the oxygen tension by clearing the atelectasis. And CPAP, whenever required, also is the biggest advantage in preventing or treating this atelectasis. The second problem is postoperative pneumonia. What are the causes of this? Usually, development of pneumonia tends to occur in the first 5 postoperative days. The patient may present with fever, leukocytosis, increased secretions, pulmonary infiltrates, which all you described. And patient develops hypoxemia and eventually may develop respiratory distress. So postoperative pneumonia is a very, very serious problem which should not be ignored. And it can be ventilator-associated pneumonitis also, due to the aspiration of secretions which contain the bacteria. They colonize in the respiratory tract, and ventilator-associated pneumonia may be preceded by ventilatory tracheobronchitis, which progresses on to ventilator-assisted pneumonia. The risk factors for aspiration are what type of endotracheal tube you are using. You said about unsterile or not packed properly or not handled properly endotracheal tube. More than that, nowadays we are worried about the cuff of the endotracheal tube. I'll show you what I mean by that. And mechanical ventilation without PEEP is another reason for aspiration. And if the patient has a nasogastric tube all the time during the anesthesia, that is another factor which can lead to aspiration. And if the patient already has a GERD, gastroesophageal reflux disease, that is another reason for this particular problem. So in the immediate postoperative period, that is within the 2 hours after extubation, protective reflexes are depressed, and that is the time patient can aspirate. So the upper esophageal sphincter remains depressed. This is more likely to occur with advanced age and use of long-acting muscle relaxants. So high volume, low pressure cuffs, which we are nowadays using mainly to avoid mucosal injury because of the pressure, they have another problem. Even though they are not causing ischemic injury by pressure, they form what is called longitudinal folds because of the large surface, and form small channels in the PVC cuff. permitting transit of secretions which have collected above the cuff level, okay? So this causes aspiration, a distinct possibility even in intubated patients who can aspirate intraoperatively, especially during long duration surgical procedures or in the ICU when the patient is on the ventilator, okay? So how can we prevent this? This is how we have now got what is called the tapered cuffs are more effective in achieving tracheal seal than cylindrical cuffs. What I mean by that, this is the picture of the two cuffs. The one on the top is called the tapered cuff. You can see it is like almost a pear shaped, whereas the one at the bottom is like a circle or a cylindrical shape. So if you use that pear shaped or the tapered cuff, that is supposed to prevent the folding formation and prevent the aspiration. And nowadays we are having polyurethane cuffs which are more effective in preventing folding formation, and then the cross-sectional area ratio of the cuff to the trachea is very important. It should be 1.5 to 1, that is the cuff ratio should be little larger than the tracheal cross-sectional area, which prevents the development. When it exceeds this, it should be just ideal, 1.5 is to 1. More than that, it will, in the large cuff, that is the problem. It becomes two times or three times, which forms, because there is no space for it, it folds by itself into that. And a new cuffless tube has been designed, which has a low pressure sealing consisting of 12 to 20 polyurethane film termed gills. This tube is oval, making the better fit in the glottic level. Another method is to decrease the aspiration is continuous suction of the subglottic secretions. So below the vocal cords and above the cuff, you get the collections. So that can be aspirated with a special type of tube, which is designed to have a separate dorsal lumen. So this is the tube that you have to see. You can see here, your regular cuff is there and the pilot balloon and the inflating tube is there for to inflate the cuff. In addition to that, you can see another tube is there, which is with a yellow colored tip with a close, which you can close. And you can see the cut section of this tube. The one is for inflating the cuff, the other lumen is for aspiration. So if you attach a suction to that, whatever secretions are collecting above this cuff and the vocal cords, that is the subglottic region, can be aspirated periodically, so that when you take out, nothing will go in. So that is a newer method they have introduced, which is able to prevent the aspiration problem. And if the patient has a nasogastric tube, it renders the gastric cardiac sphincter incompetent. So before you extubate the patient, so in the anesthetic management of full stomach patient, if you have passed a stomach nasogastric tube, it should be withdrawn into the esophagus above the cardia during induction. So either some people fully remove it, or if you want to keep it, you just pull it up so that it doesn't be inside the stomach. It comes into the esophagus, but goes above the gastroesophageal junction. That is the very important method that you have to use. And when the nasogastric tube, because it favors silent aspiration and produces the postoperative pneumonia, the routine placement should be avoided as much as possible or discouraged, and selective placement should be advocated in very high risk cases. And in case you need such NG tube in place, now again a modification has been done there. A nasogastric balloon has been designed in the tube, and the balloon, when it inflated, lies at the cardia, preventing any reflex. This is the tube that you have. So this is the NG tube. This goes into the stomach, and this balloon can be inflated just like your endotracheal tube. And this balloon will lie at the cardia so that gastric contents cannot come up. So these are all the methods that have been improved or advanced in the treatment of preventing an aspiration. Now, coming to the intraoperative and postoperative problems, Limiting the duration of surgery, level of sedation in ICU is important, avoidance of using long-acting and neuromuscular blocking agents, and lubrication of PVC cuff. The intervals of cuff should be, that is, cuff pressure should be ideally 24 centimeters of water. And prophylactically, you can have a PEEP of 5 to 8 centimeters, and aspiration of subglottic secretions, and the use of special tubes, avoidance of NGT. These are all the methods of preventing the aspiration and getting into the problem of postoperative pneumonia. So after atelectasis, after pneumonia, the third problem is acute lung injury. And the acute lung injury is a hypoxic respiratory failure caused by diffuse lung injury, which is characterized by decreased lung compliance and non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema, resulting from widespread capillary leakage. The increased microvascular permeability with the increased protein in the edema fluid is the hallmark of acute lung injury, irrespective of the cause. Whatever it is happening, the acute lung injury has two components. One is the increased microvascular permeability. The second is there is a rich protein content in the edema fluid. And there are bilateral pulmonary infiltrates which may progress to white out markings in the X-ray, which is indistinguishable from ARDS. But the PCWP should be less than 18, that is pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, to be less than 18 to rule out any cardiac back pressure effect. And when the PaO2 FaO2 ratio is less than 300 millimeter, it is called acute lung injury. When it is less than 200, it is a distinguishing point from acute respiratory distress syndrome. Then ALI again can be two types. One, it can be primary, where the clinician the clinical presentation is in the immediate postoperative period, and it is due to systemic inflammatory response induced by surgical insult. The second is the secondary to occurs a little later, 3 to 12 days after surgery, when it is triggered by postoperative complications such as sepsis, pulmonary embolism, aspiration of gastric contents, pneumonia, or transfusion. The severity and presentation of acute lung injury secondary to aspiration depends on the quality of aspirated fluid and pH, especially Mendelssohn's syndrome. Now, by definition, transfusion, sometimes they ask you what is the difference between acute lung injury and transfusion-related acute injury. They ask you the definition. It is an acute onset respiratory distress, non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema developing during or within 6 hours of transfusion. After you have given a transfusion intraoperatively, and the surgery lasts only about 2 hours, and 4 hours later in the postoperative period, if the patient develops respiratory distress and non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema features, you have to suspect transfusion related. Then there are two types. One is immune mediated and another is a non-immune mediated. In immune mediated, it is due to the granulocyte binding autoantibodies, and in the non-immune mediated, it's a milder variety, neutrophil priming substance, biologically active lipid in the lipids in stored blood, and it is more benign and requires only oxygen support, whereas the other one may need a ventilatory support. So type 1 requires a more severe type, requires ventilatory support. Type 2 is a milder variety. Now coming to mechanical ventilation and acute lung injury, factors favoring ventilator-induced lung injury are high tidal volumes resulting in cyclic stretching of alveoli, exposure to higher FiO2, tissue damage leading to local inflammatory reaction in the lungs and production of radical oxygen intermediates and other inflammatory markers causing disruption of alveolar capillary membrane and pulmonary edema. Now, protecting lung ventilation strategy. This itself is sometimes asked as a short note question. So, protective lung ventilation strategy is mainly to avoid mechanical ventilation induced acute lung injury. So, low tidal volumes of 6 to 8 ml, PEEP 5 to 8 centimeters of water, and lowest possible FiO2 should be used to attain saturation of more than 90%. To prevent oxidative damage and absorption atelectasis. So if you do these three things, low tidal volume, low PEEP, and low FiO2. All three lows. If you use that, you will be able to safely ventilate these patients. And a new scoring system, namely surgical lung injury prediction score, or lung injury prediction score, which is called LIPS, has been established, wherein preoperatively the patient can be stratified as a low, intermediate, and high surgery, high risk. Of course, they say it is available online. I don't know what are the parameters you have to look into. And another newer thing is the availability of a new biomarker. What is the biomarker we use when there is a cardiac failure? Tanya.
Troponin I, troponin D, CKMB, BNP,
brain natriuretic peptide. So similar to that, nowadays we have the biomarker for lung injury also. So that is called plasma angiopoietin 2. An endothelial growth factor. It is arising from the endothelium of the vessel supplying the lung, and there is a ratio between angiopoietin 2 and angiopoietin 1, and also interleukin 8 is normally we talk about TNF alpha and interleukin 6, but here interleukin 8 is a cytokine which is available as a marker of inflammation. So if you do these things, you will know whether there is a in acute lung injury or not. So increased pulmonary leak index and severity of ALI and the mortality can be assessed using these biomarkers also. Now again, preventive strategies of acute against acute lung injury, all various measures to do that is avoidance of alcohol, improving nutritional status, improving patient's functional respiratory performance, preoperative physiotherapy, and post-operative inspiratory muscle training, optimal medical therapy, rapid correction of hypoxemia, bronchodilator, all these points you said, but they all be given under a heading so that it will look impressive for the examiners to correct it easily and give you more marks also. So maneuvers to improve respiratory functions are early mobilization, stimulation of active cough, inspiratory exercises, and preoperative non-invasive ventilation to improve respiratory reserve. Now this can be remembered by this mnemonic: I cough, incentive spirometry, coughing or deep breathing, oral hygiene, understanding and education of why you should do all these things. Mobilization is done as a getting out of bed, and keep always the head of the bed elevated in all patients coming after surgery to the post-operative ward. Now, pulmonary embolism, this is a serious post-operative complication. As I said earlier, some people include this in the pulmonary complications, but because it is mainly of cardiac origin, it can, some people don't include that, it's a controversy, but better to include that because it can sometimes result in an acute respiratory collapse, and patients usually die when you mobilize them without waiting for about 48 hours, without allowing them to move, and then you ask them to suddenly get out of the bed and walk. This is a very common problem. And if they have any history of DVT earlier, you have to be very watchful in these patients because they can go in for this problem again, okay? So these are all the points that you have to remember with this particular one. And so,
thank you, sir.
Thank you. Yeah. You can.
Next would be Dr. Saitana from Rajamuthiah Medical College, Chidambaram. She will be presenting the answer for pregnancy induced hypertension, sir.
Okay.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, myself Chaitanya Anach, and my topic is pregnancy induced hypertension, sir.
Why you are all not showing your faces at all? Why don't you just switch on your video first and show your face? Let me at least see your faces.
Yes, sir, sure. Sir, because of network problem, last time volume was not properly audible, so I switched off, sir. I'll on, sir.
Okay. Yeah, Go ahead.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
At first, pregnancy.
No, if it is going to interfere with your net connection, you can switch. Sorry, you can switch off. If your audio is getting disturbed, you can switch off the video and just talk.
Yes, sir. Sure, sir. Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Now is it audible,
now,
sir?
This topic is, yeah, it is now clear. I think your video and audio don't go together. I think some problem there.
Yes, sir. Yes,
this
sir.
Question, they have just mentioned pregnancy-induced hypertension. It, no case scenario has been given. So it is a generalized topic, which you have huge topic by itself. So you have to concise it as much as possible, but at the same time,
yes,
not
sir.
To omit any points, you have to make a presentation. Let us see how you
yes,
are
sir.
Making it. Go ahead.
Okay, sir. Pregnancy-induced hypertension. At first, the pregnancy-induced hypertension has a classification, that is gestational hypertension, preeclampsia, chronic hypertension with superimposed preeclampsia, and then eclampsia. There are five classifications. Then coming to the definition, gestational hypertension, it is the elevation of blood pressure during second half of the pregnancy or in the first 24 hours of the postpartum without proteinuria and without the symptoms. In gestational hypertension, there is mild and severe. Systolic more than 140 to 160 and diastolic more than 90 to 110. It is a mild. And severe is more than 160 and 160 systolic, diastolic is more than 110. And coming to the preeclampsia definition, it is gestational hypertension plus proteinuria developing after 20 weeks of gestation. It has a mild and severe form. Then coming to the mild form, where just like saying like gestational hypertension, 140 to 160 systolic, diastolic is 90 to 110. And with mild proteinuria, that is less than 5 gram per 24 hours. Then coming to the severe hypertension, severe preeclampsia, it has severe hypertension with severe proteinuria, then mild hypertension with severe proteinuria, and then preeclampsia plus oligouria, cerebral or visual disturbance, pulmonary edema, right upper quadrant pain, thrombocytopenia, impaired liver function. To the chronic hypertension. Hypertension complicating pregnancy is considered as chronic if patient for pregnancy. Hypertension present prior to 20 weeks of gestation and first it is present longer than 6 weeks after delivery. This is chronic hypertension. And then women with the chronic hypertension are at risk of developing superimposed preeclampsia. That is our fourth type of gestational hypertension, where it is an excess. Then coming to the fifth one classification, that is eclampsia. Eclampsia is the occurrence of the seizures in a woman with preeclampsia. When seizures are not due to any other cause, there are other many differential diagnoses of seizures where all those are evaluated, then that seizure can be considered along with the preeclampsia. This seizure usually occurs within 48 hours of delivery. Now coming to the preeclampsia, the risk factors of preeclampsia is maternal factors like primiparity, previous preeclamptic pregnancy, chronic hypertension, chronic renal disease, history of thrombophilia, multifetal pregnancy, in vitro fertilization, family history, diabetes, obesity, SLE, and advanced maternal age. Then coming to the biomarkers of this preeclampsia, angiogenesis related biomarkers, that is anti-angiogenic proteins, like soluble FMs like tyrosine kinase 1 and soluble endoglin. And then pro-angiogenic factors like placental growth factors, so and vascular endothelial growth factors and placental protein 13. Now coming to the etiopathogenesis of preeclampsia. In the etiopathogenesis, at first there is normal placentation and the maternal syndrome. What is this abnormal placentation is, in a normal pregnant woman, that there is trophoblastic invasion in the decidual segments. And because of this, the myometrial portion remain very dilated and the spiral arteries remain dilated and they won't have any tone. But whereas in this preeclampsia, failure of trophoblastic invasion caused decidual segmental change. Myometrial portion remains small and constricted and hyper-responsive to vasomotor stimuli. And failure of normal angiogenesis. then this causes superficial placentation. This causes abnormal maternal response to this placentation, leading to decreased placental perfusion, placental influx that can lead to IUGR. And this is asymptomatic first stage of the abnormal placentation. Then in the symptomatic second stage, there is a decreased perfusion of the intervillous space because of the decreased placental perfusion. This causes widespread maternal endothelial dysfunction, leading to systemic inflammatory response without IUGR that leads to preeclampsia. The unknown etiologies like the endothelial damage because of this preeclampsia can cause increased platelet aggregation and thrombocytopenia and hemolytic anemia and increased liver enzymes that will cause a condition called as HELLP syndrome, which will be discussed further, sir. And then another cause like decreased production of vasodilatory substances will cause decreased sensitivity to vasodilating substances, leading to increased systemic vascular resistance. That leads to hypertension. And one more thing is increased vascular sensitivity to angiotensin norepinephrine, leading to vasospasm. This leads to decreased in GFR and renal blood flow, leading to decreased aldosterone escape, increased sodium water retention, ultimately hypertension and edema, which leads to preeclampsia or eclampsic state. And then one more factor is increased glomerular capillary permeability and proteinuria, which leads to edema and again preeclampsia and eclampsic state. Now coming to the genetic factors of etiopathogenesis, early form will be like symptom before 34 weeks and abnormal placentation, high recurrence genetic content is present in the early form. Late form will be symptoms after 34 weeks, long-standing hypertension, obese, diabetic, serious disease. This is decompensated near term, leading to postpartum preeclampsia. Then coming to the immunological factors of the preeclampsia is maternal killer immunoglobulin receptors are present. Then trophoblastic human leukocyte antigen is present. Angiotensin 1 receptor activating autoantibodies are present. Then anti-angiogenic proteins, which already described, like soluble FMs like tyrosine kinase 1 and soluble endoglin, increased in HELLP syndrome specifically. Now coming to the pathophysiological changes in the preeclampsia. Hemodynamic changes like decreased cardiac output, decreased central venous pressure, then pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, increased systemic vascular resistance, then pulmonary capillary wedge pressure and central venous pressure difference will be higher. It will be like more than 8 to 10 mmHg, and then increased left ventricular function. Left ventricular function. Then coming to the one more pathophysiological changes, pulmonary edema and severe preeclampsia. It will be like of two types. One is non-cardiogenic and another one is cardiogenic. Now coming to the non-cardiogenic, it is because of increased capillary permeability leading to plasma oncotic pressure decrease and then hypoalbuminemia. To narrowing of plasma oncotic pressure and pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, leading to pulmonary edema. Now coming to the cardiogenic causes is left ventricular systolic dysfunction and left ventricular diastolic dysfunction. Systolic is very severe compared to diastolic, whereas left ventricular systolic dysfunction has ventricular contractile function depressed. And in diastolic dysfunction, left ventricular is hypertrophy and stroke volume and cardiac output are normal only. In systolic dysfunction, older multiparous dilated cardiomyopathy, chronic hypertension can lead to pulmonary edema. In diastolic dysfunction, because of left ventricular hypertrophy, increased ring volume will be there, increased left ventricular and diastolic pressure leading to increased fetal pregnancy and chronic hypertension patients can be seen in these things. And treatment of these includes, like in a brief, I'm telling, sir, diuretics, antihypertensive, beta blockers, and calcium antagonists. And then coming to the respiratory changes in the preeclampsia is airway changes and respiratory system changes. Airway changes will be like facial airway edema, narrowing of the upper airway, vocal cord edema, tongue large, less mobile, increased Mallampati score, increased weight gain and large breast, increased incidence of difficult or failed intubation because of these changes in preeclampsia women's. Now, coming to the respiratory changes, there will be increased O2 capacity, decreased functional residual capacity because of the weight gain and enlarged gravid uterus. Then rapid development of hypoxemia with and difficult in difficult and failed intubation and difficult mask can happen because of these changes. Then coming to the central nervous system changes like headache, visual disturbance because of some emboli in the retinal arteries and all, then hyperirritability, hyperreflexia, seizures, coma, focal ischemia, or cerebral edema are the central nervous system changes. Then coming to the coagulation abnormalities like increased adrenergic stimulation like endothelial cell damage will be there, platelet thrombi formation will be there, intravascular platelet activation, platelet consumption, platelet agglutination will be there. So occlusion of arterioles and capillaries, then thrombocytopenia. Now coming to the hepatic abnormalities like periportal necrosis, subcapsular hemorrhage, fibrin deposits in sinusoids, impairment in function, hepatomegaly, fatty liver, rupture of liver, like in HELLP syndrome, complicated states. Then coming to the renal complications like decreased GFR, renal flow, vasospasm, increased BUN, then serum creatinine and uric acid also will be increased. Then acute renal failure cases, oliguria, azotemia kind of conditions can be present. The complications will be because of preeclampsia will be like maternal complications, fetal complications. Maternal will be like convulsion, eclampsia, cerebrovascular accident, cerebral edema, intracranial hemorrhage, congestive heart failure, pulmonary edema. Fetal complications like preterm labor, IUGR, then meconium aspiration, intracranial or intraventricular hemorrhage, chorioamnionitis can be present in the fetal part. Then early predictors of this preeclampsia is rollover test, then angiotensin 2 infusion test, the raised plasma fibrin per DL, hypocalcemia, raised placental peptides like CRH, activin A, inhibin B. Now coming to the preoperative evaluation of these preeclampsia, eclampsia and chronic hypertension, pregnancy-induced hypertension in brief. Preoperative evaluation will be like clinical. In that, duration and severity of preeclampsia to be noted, compliance with the therapy, time and dose and of last drug intake, that is MGS of max sulfate, and assessment of other organ involvement, coexistent diseases, history of last food intake, airway assessment, intravascular volume status assessment. Coming to the investigations, complete blood count, hemoconcentration, peripheral blood smear, blood urea, serum, creatinine, uric acid, then liver function test, coagulation studies, D-dimer, BT-CT, PT-INR, urine analysis, baseline ultrasound for fetal growth, then non-stress test, necessary investigations to be done. And then coming to the preoperative optimization, like certain things to control the uncontrolled hypertensive state. General like bed rest, nurse in left lateral position, diuretics if pulmonary edema present, then cross-matched blood should be kept ready, continuous fetal monitoring should be there, then secure two IV lines all the time. Then IV fluids at 60 to 125 ml per hour, ringer lactate or NS to be maintained. Urine output 1 ml per kg per hour to be maintained. Then central venous pressure should be around 4 to 5 mmHg. 5 to 10 mmHg of pulmonary capillary wedge pressure should be maintained. Then antihypertensives, when the BP is too much, antihypertensives to be put. That is hydralazine, that is 5 to 10 mg IV every 20 minutes up to 40 mg. Then labetalol, 20 injection labetalol, 20 mg IV, then 40 to 80 mg IV every 20 to 15 minutes up to maximum dose of 300 mg IV. Then sodium nitroprusside, start infusion 0.3 to 0.5 microgram per kg per minute, increase in increments up to 0.5 per kg per minute to maximum 5 microgram per kg per minute. Then nitroglycerin, start infusion with 5 microgram per minute up to maximum dose of 200 to 300 microgram per minute. Then coming to the nicardipine, infusion at 2.5 milligram per hour at a rate increasing by 2.5 milligram per hour to 15 milligram per hour can be increased. Then seizure prophylaxis, like Pritchard regimen, that is max sulfate regimen, that will be in the while explaining about eclampsia. Then seizure prophylaxis include Prichard regimen, then diazepam 5 to 10 milligram followed by 30 milligram in 500 ml NS or phenytoin 10 milligram per kg loading dose 5 milligram per kg at 24 at 2 hours. Then thiopentone sodium 75 to 100 milligram IV for immediate control. Then than 1 lakh and use whole blood FFP platelet, keep ready whole blood FFP platelet concentration state and anything required can be transfused also. Then coming to the monitoring, they are monitoring SpO2, NIPP, ECG, Foley's catheter, urine output monitoring, pentone reflexes to be monitored when the patient is on max sulfate regimens, then maternal muscle strength, max sulfate level, fetal heart rate monitoring, invasive BP only if there is refractive hypertension and rapid acting vasodilating therapy, then central venous pulmonary artery catheterization can be done in pulmonary edema and oliguria in the severe forms, then capnography and neuromuscular monitoring. Now coming to the anesthesia of pre-eclampsia, what is the anesthetic considerations in pre-eclampsic patient? In pre-eclampsic patient, at first, perioperative fluid management is very important. Seeing urine output, we need to give a fluid challenge of 250 ml of crystallized solution, and if the challenge is good and if the patient is fine, then input and output monitoring and enough fluid substitution can be done for the of the pre-eclampsic patient. And then the choice of anesthesia in pre-eclampsic patients include, in a severe form, better to go with general anesthesia when there is a contraindication for regional anesthesia. And it is important for pre-eclampsic patient, hypertension is well controlled, seizure prophylaxis is initiated and volume status is optimized. Then all monitoring things should be properly done, like BP, ECG, capnography, saturation, then two free-flowing IV lines to be maintained, and then platelet count if it is less than 80 lakh, less than 80 lakh, it is contraindicated for regional anesthesia, can go for general by infusing FFP if necessity. And then the most suitable one is epidural anesthesia, because the labor analgesia, the reason is it increases the intravillous blood flow improvement and decrease in maternal basal metabolic rate, and oxygen consumption is also decreased, and the circulating catecholamines are also decreased. So labor analgesia, with 10 ml of bupivacaine 0.125% mixed with fentanyl 2 milligram per ml, or 0.2% plain ropivacaine as a loading dose, following 10 to 20 ml per hour of the same mixture as epidural infusion. It is the best method. Then coming to the regional anesthesia, there is choices conventional epidural, single shot spinal, and combined spinal epidural anesthesia can be done with these patients. And hypotension needs to be properly monitored and to be kept in mind. If the BP is less than 30% of the baseline, then vasopressors can be used. Phenylephrine can be used. And it should be administered very cautiously, only if the heart rate is more than 120 per minute. And then coming to the general anesthesia, it can only be done when there is refusal of regional anesthesia, emergency cesarean delivery for fetal bradycardia, coagulopathy, hypovolemia, severe hemorrhage. In such conditions, general anesthesia can be used for these patients. General anesthesia in such patients and in severe preeclampsia. What are the conditions? What are the things to be considered in general anesthesia for severe preeclampsia? Here, additional large bore intravenous catheter to be kept, and then small size ET tubes, supraglottic airway to be kept. Then equipment, whatever needed for difficult airway management, should be present. And then administration of ranitidine metoclopramide before 32 or 60 minutes before the induction of anesthesia is better. Then denitrogenate the patient with the 3 minutes of tidal volume breathing or 8 vital capacity of breaths of FiO2 of 100%. And then tight fitting mask. Then necessary antihypertensives like labetalol and esmolol and nicardipine, nitroglycerin, these can be given in order to suppress the intubation response. And fetal heart rate monitoring should be done. sideways, and then perform rapid sequence induction with propofol 2 to 2.8 milligram per kg, and scholine 1 to 1.5 succinyl scholine with 1 to 1.5 milligram per kg, and avoid ketamine because it increases the sympathomimetic properties. And consider administration of this labetalol, esmolol, nitroglycerin in order to blunt the response of laryngoscopy. Then maintain anesthesia with volatile halogenated agent of about 2/3 of the normal value with 100% oxygen. And after delivery, decrease the concentration of volatile agent and to prevent uterine atony, and consider nitrous oxide after delivery or a propofol infusion with the opioid or a benzodiazepine, which gives additional plane of anesthesia, deep plane of anesthesia. Then avoid additional muscle relaxant in case if the patient is on a max sulfate regimen, just to lower the dose in order to, because of the exaggerated effect of these medications when administered with the magnesium, like muscle relaxant effect will be more and prolonged. And then coming to the one of the complication of preeclampsia, that next part is management of eclamptic seizures. Preoperative management is just the same as a preeclampsia, what I already told. Now, when an eclamptic seizure is present, how to manage? Airway to be taken care, apply jaw thrust, tilt the patient to the left, or manually displace the uterus to the left with a bench. Protect the head and the body from the injury. Breathing should be carefully absorbed. And then attempt ventilation using bag and gown mask with 100% oxygen. And do not insert the oral airway. If necessary, insert a soft and well-lubricated nasal airway. Apply pulse oximeter. Continuously monitor SpO2, circulation, intravenous access. Continuously monitor ECG, blood pressure. Then if hypertension present, treat the hypertension with the mentioned drugs previously, then the drug, and then max sulfate regimen. This max sulfate regimen, Pritchard's regimen. In this regimen, the patient is given max sulfate, that is 4 to 6 gram IV over 15 to 20 minutes as a loading dose. Then 1 to 2 gram per hour IV for maintenance. Then 2 gram IV over 5 to 10 minutes for recurrent seizures. And even it can also be given as a total 10 gram, that is 5 gram each to buttocks, 5 gram each can be given in the IM form. And then later, alternatively to 4 gram max sulfate is given IM to each buttock every 4 hours. This is Pritchard's regimen. There are some regimens like Zestman regimen, Sidma regimen, Lytic cocktail regimen, Lean regimen. These are the other regimens in order to treat the seizures in the eclamptic patients. And then coming to the one more complication, that is HELLP syndrome. HELLP syndrome, it consists of hemolysis, elevated liver enzymes, and low platelet count. Hemolysis, it can be interpreted with increased bilirubin more than 1.2 milligram per DL, increased LDH more than 600 international units per liter. Then elevated liver enzyme, like increased AST more than 70 international units per liter, then increased LDH more than 600 international units per liter. Then thrombocytopenia, platelet count where it is less than 1 lakh. These are the conditions which will diagnose HELLP syndrome. One is complete HELLP and incomplete HELLP. Complete HELLP will be having all these symptoms. Incomplete will have one or two of the above. Then there are differential diagnosis of HELLP syndrome, like acute fatty liver of pregnancy, cholestasis of pregnancy, appendicitis, diabetes insipidus, gallbladder disease, gastroenteritis, hemolytic uremia, hepatic encephalopathy, idiopathic thrombocytopenia, peptic ulcer, SLE, then viral hepatitis. These are the differential diagnosis of HELLP syndrome. Then the pathophysiology is already mentioned before. That is, in this patient, there will be increased platelet aggregation, and that will lead to thrombocytopenia, hemolytic anemia, and increased liver enzymes. It is all because of the vascular endothelial dysfunction. And then coming to the clinical features, it will be like occurs before 36 weeks of gestation with a headache, nausea, vomiting, visual disturbance, and then epigastric pain more specifically, then shoulder pain, and shoulder pain on deep breathing, the decay sign, and then bleeding, gut hemorrhage, retinal hemorrhage, edema, mild hypertension, acute renal failure with oliguria, which is most important to be noted. And these are the clinical features of HELLP syndrome. And then coming to the management, early diagnosis is the best form of management. And then symptomatic therapy like optimized fluid therapy, optimized blood therapy, IV fluids, nurse in left lateral position, O2 supplementation, soft mouth gag, Foley's catheter for input-output monitoring, then antihypertensives, which I already mentioned for preeclampsia, and then anticonvulsive therapy mentioned as in eclampsia. Then definitive therapy is only by delivery, either by via caesarean section under general anesthesia or even regional anesthesia. If even regional anesthesia can also be given, only if it is contraindicated, then general anesthesia is preferred. Then the corticoid steroids, the steroid therapy for immature fetus. Then coming to the complications of HELLP syndrome, it can lead to liver hematoma, infarction, liver failure, pulmonary edema, embolism, DIC, abruption, and then GI bleed, retinal detachment, acute renal failure, ARDS, and sepsis and stroke. These are the complications of HELLP syndrome. And thus, this ends the brief form of pregnancy-induced hypertension.
My God. Did you use a stopwatch before you practiced and presented here? And
no, sir, I didn't.
You did that? Did you use a stopwatch and see how long you are taking to present this?
No, sir, I did not use stopwatch, but I made my points very specifically. I made notes of it, and I just went on presenting it, sir.
Very good. Okay. See, you have roughly taken almost about 35 minutes to present the whole thing. And for just reciting or saying it from what you have written in a paper, do you think you will be able to write everything like that in this same 35 minutes in the examination?
No, sir, and the question also will not be this elaborative.
Yeah,
it will be with one of the
I told
part
you this is one of the question is very vague and rather doesn't clearly give you an idea about what to write. That's why I told you in the beginning itself, it's a very generalized question, generalized topic, which encompasses everything. So the main idea of if such questions, you know, foolishly sometimes they ask you such questions in the exam also. Describe the anesthetic management of a patient with pregnancy induced hypertension. That will be the question wordings. That
yes,
I've seen the question banks, if you go through, questions are given like that. But it is your as a duty for a student to diligently cut short it and make it concise and make it presentable within the 20 minutes time you have for each and every question. If you are a DNB student, you have only 18 minutes for the 10 questions that you have. As I have earlier said, you have 3 hours paper with 10 questions and 180 minutes divided by 10, you have roughly only 18 minutes for a question to answer.
Okay,
of course,
sir.
There will be
okay,
a combination of a long question and short question. So even if you adjust in that way, you will get maximum 25 to 30 minutes for a question like this. So what
okay,
you have
sir.
To do is highlight which are all the points are important. Okay. So
okay, sir.
Now you have been repeating several things like your magnesium sulfate therapy Pichat. Came 2-3 times, you again repeating it again and again. So
yes,
you should make it in such a way that what you have said earlier should not be repeated again, so that it will be a wastage of time. And
okay,
the serious previously we were classifying, of course, the pregnancy induced hypertension, you start with the definition of it is a new onset hypertension occurring after 20 weeks of gestation. That is the definition of pregnancy induced hypertension. If it is associated with proteinuria, it becomes preeclampsia. If it is not associated with proteinuria, it is just a pregnancy induced hypertension. And majority of the patients go on only in that category. If you see 100 pregnant women coming for antenatal checkup, or about 10% if they develop, if they come under the category of pregnancy-induced hypertension. 90% of them will be having a hypertension which can be controlled with oral medications, and then they can go on to normal or cesarean delivery without any other further complications. On the contrary, 10% may develop proteinuria and go to the category of preeclampsia, and even among them, very few will go for the serious complication of eclampsia or the HELLP syndrome. So these two complications are fairly very, very rare occurrences. So commonly seen conditions are either a simple pregnancy-induced hypertension or a patient with a preeclampsia without much serious complication. Previously, we used to classify them as mild, moderate, and severe based on the blood pressure. But the present day classification is to classify preeclampsia with mild symptoms and serious symptoms. Like that only we are classifying. We are not worried about the degree of blood pressure and all these things now. And one point which you should have stressed here is they should come for regular antenatal checkup. And as soon as they have been diagnosed with hypertension, they must be found out whether they have any additional features like headache, constant headache, or visual disturbance, or epigastric pain. That word did not come at all in your description of this huge nature. So, constantly look for that and start them on oral antihypertensive treatment. That is the first thing you have to describe, because majority of the cases, even when you go out and practice as a freelance or an anesthesiologist, you will come across patients who are having a mild hypertension, who have been prescribed antihypertensive agents by the physician. Okay, so they will be either on nifedipine or the labetalol, or this tablet form oral preparations will be given. And the most important thing, antenatal instruction that should be given to them, is to come for a periodic blood pressure measurement and proteinuria assessment. And if they develop any edema, then that should also be reported immediately. Okay, so this is the instruction that should be given to the patient, and the follow-up is very, very important. That should be highlighted in your answer. And then, of course, you have mentioned the pathophysiology. When you mention that, you have to go like system-wise. Of course, you mentioned that, but you said pathophysiology in cardiovascular, pathophysiology in respiratory, pathophysiology in renal. Instead of that, system-wise involvement, you go for CVS, RS, renal, coagulation, and albumin, all these things like that, you can go and you have can describe all these things in that orderly fashion. And then the magnesium can be elaborated a little bit more, because you didn't mention the toxic levels of magnesium at all. More than mentioning the Pritchard and other names and other things, more importantly, you should know that what is the safe limit of magnesium that you can give. What blood level you will have the abolition of petalar reflex, at what level you will have the respiratory depression, at what level you will have go for a cardiac depression. So that point has to be mentioned definitely, because that only will impress the examiner that you are aware of the complications of this treatment. Okay, so that point has to be mentioned in your answer. And you don't need to write about the gluteal dosage of 4 gram, this gram, all these things are given in the textbooks, but nobody follows that. If at all you want to give magnesium, you give only about intravenous. Nowadays, I don't think any physician practices intramuscular magnesium like what they did in the yester years. So if at all they start the patient on magnesium sulfate, you have to go for IV induction. And that is usually 2 to 4 grams IV or bolus as a first dose, then followed by intravenous infusion. At that point, you have to mention what are all the safe limits and where you will go in for complications if you don't follow it up properly. Okay, that is a very important point that you have to mention there. Then finally, you have to discuss about that anesthetic management. You have to say general versus, instead of writing round and about again and again about all the techniques, you can say GA versus RA. And the main important indications were, because majority world over, we prefer only a single shot spinal as the technique for any cesarean section. That is the first and foremost choice. Nobody uses epidural or combined spinal in the present day scenario. Based on the surgeon's speed and ability and other complications, the first preferred technique is a single shot spinal because of its easy technicality and its safety on the mother as well as the fetus. Okay? So unfortunately, when the coagulation profile is abnormal and you are worried about a bleeding, you then go for general anesthesia. And in your flow and your anxiety, you said 8 lakhs of platelets. That is not the correct answer.
80,000, sir. 80,000, I told you. 80,000.
I heard at 80 lakhs or something like that. Okay.
No, so sir. You have less than 80,000.
Like then 80,000. Okay. Again, you are saying 80 lakhs. So 80,000 is the limit below which?
80,000, sir.
Yeah, 80,000. Okay. So that is the limit. And spinal anesthesia has to be modified a little bit. You don't give the same 2.5 ml or 2 ml as you give for a regular cesarean section in these cases, especially if the patient's blood pressure is very high. Then what they advocate is you give a combination of local anesthetic with the narcotic in the form of fentanyl. So a total volume of 2 ml comprising of 1.5 ml of 0.5% bupivacaine with half per 0.5 ml of fentanyl, which is 25 micrograms. That total volume 2 ml is supposed to be a very safe dose of subarachnoid block, which does not cause a sudden crash in BP, or at the same time it is sufficient to even to withstand the fundal pressure and other discomfort the patient may experience if you have not added any narcotic. Okay, so that is the only point, sir, that you may have to add. And then the other methods of GA, you have to be very careful about not only the hypertensive response during laryngoscopy and intubation. You have to quickly do that rapid intubation within 15 seconds of paralysis is very important to prevent exacerbation. But at the same time, when the some cases the BP may drop also. In that situation, instead of rushing fluids, you have to go for a vasopressor, because even though there will be volume contracted, there are chances that in severe cases they may have a leaky capillaries everywhere, which can produce an edema. So that problem you have to mention about. So like highlight all these things, and once you do that, that will be a better version of answering. And so you have to make it a little more concise so that you can complete the answer within the given 20 minutes. Whatever you have said, I have to, if you have to take a class, it may take only this topic alone will be available and not the other one. So anyway, okay. I'll just see what happens. Are you able to see? Is the screen visible now?
No, sir.
No,
no, sir.
Okay. Another presentation that is stop sharing. Right, that is not coming. Okay, right. We'll keep it for some other time. Right. So that is the thing that you have to take care of. Okay. And one more thing, you don't have to unnecessarily waste time on writing about the chronic hypertension or the chronic hypertension, superimposed preeclampsia, all these things you can just mention and rapidly go through with, as a one-liner, and then proceed mainly with the antenatal care that you have to give to this patient, plus the management. Of course, you said fluid management is very important. And you mentioned about CVP and PA pressures and all these things. That is only for very, very sick ladies and sick mothers who are very seriously having a problem like HELLP syndrome or very high anasarca edema.
Yes.
Those patients
Yes, sir.
had a consistently high BP, which has gone on to some stages like accelerated hypertension or malignant hypertension. Only for such cases, advanced invasive measurements are important. Otherwise, majority of the cases we can manage with the regular IB lines and non-invasive BP. All these things are more than enough. Okay, so hydrate and do that. Okay, right.
Okay,
right.
Sir.
For the next question.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Chetna. Next will be Dr. Akshay from Jagjivaram Hospital. Dr. Akshay from Jagjivaram Hospital, Mumbai, Western Railway. He will be presenting ECMO, need of the hour. Over to Dr. Akshay. Dr. Akshay, you can just start, and you can start your video also. And audio. Dr. Akshay, unmute yourself. Unmuted, sir.
Yeah.
Good,
wow. Good evening, Shai.
Good evening, sir.
Nice to see you again. Okay. Go ahead.
Today I'll be presenting on the topic extracorporeal membrane oxygenation, that is ECMO. ECMO is modified adaptation of conventional cardiopulmonary bypass technique.
Very
for
good.
Prolonged cardiopulmonary support. Sir, am I audible, sir?
Yeah. You are audible. Go ahead.
Okay. I'll repeat once again. ECMO is modified adaptation of conventional cardiopulmonary bypass technique for prolonged cardiopulmonary support.
Okay.
In that, we based on the technique of cannulation, there is a intrathoracic type of cannulation after sternotomy, and there is extra thoracic type of cannulation in the peripheries. And again, we can also classify it as venovenous and venoarterial. ECMO is currently used to support the patients with respiratory or cardiac failure who are unresponsive to conventional therapeutic intervention. Coming to the brief history of ECMO, in 1971, Dr. Donald Hill treated a 24-year-old polytrauma patient with ruptured aorta. That is the first patient who is treated with ECMO and recovered. In the following few years, not much of success in ECMO outcome was seen compared to the newer ventilatory strategies. This has put the ECMO in the backyard of the management. Later on in 1976, application of ECMO in a respiratory failure, first in the neonate was done, and the baby survived. And she was named as Esperanza, also known as the Hope. In 1989, a character was created, that is extracorporeal life support organization, also known as ELSO, was formed with the purpose of stimulating multi-institutional research. ECMO is opted on, that is about the brief history of the ECMO. I'm not going in detail about the history. Coming on later, ECMO is opted only when there is greater than 80% predicted mortality. Going to the indices from which we can opt a patient to put in ECMO, there are a few indices from which we can decide whether to put the patient in ECMO or not. First in indices is oxygenation indices index, that is oxygenation index mean area pressure into FiO2 into 100 divided by PaO2. If it is more than 40, or if it is more than 35 for 4 hours, we can choose to put the patient into ECMO. Then coming to the ventilation index. Ventilation index is respiratory rate into peak air, peak inspiratory pressure minus that of PEEP divided by 100. If this is more than 90 for 4 hours, we can choose to put the patient on ECMO. Then coming to the alveolar arterial oxygen difference, if it is more than 600 mmHg, despite normal ventilatory strategies for 4 to 12 hours, we can shift to the patient to the ECMO. Or if the PaO2 is less than 50 mmHg for 2 to 12 hours with FiO2 of 100%, or if the pH is less than 7.25 for 2 hours with intractable hypotension, we may choose the patient to put into ECMO. Then coming to the ECMO circuit, the components are cannula. As previously I told, it can be intrathoracic after sternotomy, or it can be extrathoracic. That is about the cannula. And later comes the roller or impeller pump. Then comes the membrane oxygenator, heat exchanger, PVC tubing and connector, and there is bladder reservoir. Blood is drawn through a cannula by roller or centrifugal pump. Later, it is put into a collapsible bladder, which acts as an compliant reservoir. This blood is then drained into the roller pump and pushed it through the silicone membrane oxygenator, followed by the heat exchanger, before returning it to the patient. The whole process requires anticoagulation in the circuit, because the blood is withdrawn from the body and then again it is reinserted in the body. The whole process requires the anticoagulation. Anticoagulation is mainly achieved with heparin, with initial bolus dose of 100 units, international units per kg, followed by an infusion of 125 international per kg per hour to maintain activated clotting time at around 180 to 200 seconds. Then coming to the difference between the veno arterial and veno venous ECMO, the basic difference is between veno arterial and veno venous ECMO is the cannulation in veno arterial ECMO is done in one in the vein and one in the artery. From the vein, the blood is withdrawn, and from and again the blood is injected into an artery. And in veno venous ECMO, the blood is withdrawn from the vein, and again the blood is pushed back into the venous system itself. Okay, coming to the veno arterial ECMO, the vein we choose is internal jugular vein or femoral vein. In artery, we can choose a right common carotid artery or axillary artery or femoral artery or aorta. From the vein, internal jugular vein or femoral vein, we are draining the blood, and again after oxygenation through the silicone oxygenator, then again we are putting back the blood into the patient's system in the artery, that is right common carotid artery, axillary artery or femoral artery or aorta. We can choose any of these. Then in veno venous system, there is single cannulation technique wherein cannulate IGV or right atrium is cannulated, and the, in the same cannula we are again injecting the blood back in the same system. Or in the double cannulation technique, either jugular femoral technique or femoro-femoral technique or saphenous technique, we'll drain the blood from the jugular. Again, we in jugular femoral cannulation, we'll drain the blood from the jugular vein, and later on again pump back the blood into the femoral system. And in femoro-femoral system, we drain the blood from the femoral cannulation and again drain back into the femoral vein. And in saphenous cannulation, we drain the blood from the saphenous vein and again put it back into the saphenous system. And if we are comparing arterial PaO2 between the veno arterial and veno venous, the arterial PaO2 in veno arterial will be 60 to 150 mm of Hg, and veno venous it will be 45 to 80 mm of Hg. Coming to the indications of the veno arterial are that is refractory cardiogenic shock or refractory cardiac arrest or bridging to the bridging device as to that of cardiac transplantation. Veno arterial type of ECMO is mainly used when there is both when there is a need for both respiratory as well as that of cardiac support, such as like cardiogenic shock, acute heart failure, pulmonary embolism, overdose from narcotics and sepsis, or refractory cardiogenic shock, as I told previously, which requires more than two inotropes along with the cardiac implantable device. And in case of that of refractory cardiac arrest and bridging to the cardiac transplantation. While in that of veno-venous ECMO, it is mainly done when there is respiratory support is necessary for the patient. Coming to the indication for veno-venous, it is hypoxemic respiratory failure, that is type 1 respiratory failure, or hypercapnic respiratory failure, that is type 2 respiratory failure, wherein pH is less than 7.2, in these patients, the routine ventilatory strategies are failed. And in case of bridging therapy during lung transplantation, veno-venous ECMO can be done. Also, in case of ARDS, pulmonary contusion, inhalational injury, status asthmaticus, and in case of lung transplant rejection, veno-venous type of ECMO has been tried out. Coming to the cardiovascular system effects during the veno arterial ECMO, the preload is decreased in veno arterial type of ECMO, and afterload is increased. Pulse pressure becomes lower, CVP is variable, and coronary oxygenation is also variable. Then left ventricle blood pressure is also variable. Then coming to the O2 delivery capacity, when comparing veno arterial and veno venous, veno arterial type of ECMO has high oxygen delivery capacity to the patient. Then coming to the circulatory support, we can provide partial or complete circulatory support in case that of veno arterial type of ECMO, but veno venous type of ECMO will only provide oxygenation to the patient, the whole pumping action and the peripheral circulation has to be taken by the patient itself or patient's circulatory system, that is the heart. Coming to the contraindication of the ECMO, it includes like such as advanced age, severe neurological dysfunction, significant comorbidities like metastasis, cirrhosis, renal failure, and multi-organ failure, non-reversible pathologies in the patient in whom even after the ECMO, the patient will not be candidate for survival. In morbid obesity, these are all the contraindications for ECMO. There is a score that is Murray score for choosing the candidate for veno-venous ECMO. It includes components like chest X-ray. It is scored from 0 to 4. Maximum score being 16. It has 4 components, that is chest X-ray. When there is one lobe of consolidation, there it is numbered as 1, and there is 2 lobes of consolidation, it is number the score of 2 is given. And when there is a score of 3, when there is 3 lobes consolidation, a score of 3 is given, and followed by when there is 4 lobes of consolidation, a 4 number is given, a score of 4 is given, like that. In hypoxemia, that is PaO2 by FiO2, if it is more than 300, a score of 0 is given. 0 is given. 225 to 300, score of 1 is given. 225 to 175, score of 2 is given. 175 to 100, a score of 3 is given. Less than 100, that is very severe, a score of 4 is given. Then again, coming to the PEEP requirement of the patient, if the PEEP required is less than 5, a score of 0 is given. Then a PEEP of 6 to 8, a score of 1 is given. Then a score of 9 to 11, a score of 2 is given. And a PEEP of 12 to 14, a score of 3 is given. And greater than 15 PEEP, a score of 4 is given. Then compliance. If the compliance is more than 80, a score of 0 is given. 80 to 60, score of 1, and 60 to 40, score of 2, and 40 to 20, score of 3, and less than 20, score of 4 is given. The maximum score being 16, and the components of Murray score are chest X-ray, number of consolidation lobes in chest X-ray, hypoxemia, PEEP, and compliance. If the score is more than 4, the patient is put on veno-venous ECMO. And based on the higher the score, the more severity of the mortality, and lower the score is less severity of the mortality. This is about the Murray score. Then coming to the if I am speaking about ECMO, I should mention about the seizure trial, which a Murray score of greater than 3 were put into ECMO group, and other group in second group, the patient were treated with conventional ventilatory strategy. This was a randomized control trial, and they found that 67% survival rate in the ECMO group and 47% survival rate in that of conventional ventilatory management. This trial showed that the patient with who were managed with conventional ventilator strategies were having a better survival rate. Then also along with EOLA trial, the 60-day mortality rate was not significantly lower than that of ECMO group when compared to conventional ventilatory management. Both this CESAR trial and EOLA trial failed to prove the effectiveness of the ECMO as in better outcome when compared to the conventional ventilatory strategies. But there was a large multicentric RCT done combining both the CESAR and EOLA trial that showed better mortality, 90-day mortality was significantly lower in that of ECMO group. And there is during the recent pandemic times, because of the COVID-19, there was a study done in French study of 83 patients who had severe COVID-19 related ARDS who were managed with ECMO, showed that estimated that the 60-day mortality of 31%. This was published in Lancet trial. Recently, with the pandemic situation after COVID-19 outbreak, SARS-CoV-2, due to its high virulence, has caused havoc on the countries worldwide with an overwhelming number of infection leading to the severe ARDS. This strategy or this extracorporeal life support has become the need of the hour.
Completed? You have completed your answer.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. That was a hope. A little.
Right.
About
yeah. Again, as I said for the earlier two speakers, the time management is very, very important. Okay. So, within that short time available for attending each and every question, your answers must be planned in such a way, and you should have prepared it in such a way so that you can present it within about 18 to 20 minutes. When you are speaking itself, you can speak faster. If you are able to complete the answer within 20 minutes, you will be able to write it at least in 25 minutes time. Okay. And now you are reading it from your laptop or your papers and other things, but you, in the exam, you have to write it from your memory. So, you have to, before presenting in this forum, what you have to do is read it again and again and get it into your mind and try to practice saying without looking at any reference or any written papers, so that you will be able to write it fast in the examination also. Okay. So what you have said all are valid points, but you have not mentioned many points. Of course, the question is ECMO, the need of the hour. That is also to draw your attention to the need of this pandemic COVID-19, where ECMO has proved to be a very useful tool in patients who are having most resistant hypoxemia. Okay, so that is no doubt about it. But majority of the answers should be more pertaining to the ECMO itself, how it is beneficial, what are the disadvantages, what are the complications, all these things have to be quickly mentioned. And then finally, you can say this is the ultimate for the patients who cannot be managed by non-invasive or invasive ventilation. This ultimately proves to be the only solution to provide oxygen to those patients. So that is how you can complete. And if you start writing about all the trials that are available, then you won't have time to mention the main points what you have to write. So I thought I will just show you on PPT. Is it visible now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. this is the so extracorporeal life support for severe respiratory failure has seen an exponential growth the recent years. So that will be a method of opening. So you can just mention, cut down all the history part of it, what you have mentioned, to a bare minimum, and then go straight away for bang on that answer, what you are expected to do. So ECMO is one, not only for oxygenation, nowadays we are using it for CO2 removal also. So it is called ECCO2R, represent two modalities that are partial support of living lung function when mechanical ventilation is either unable to achieve sufficient oxygenation to meet the metabolic demands, or when it is intensity is considered injurious. So what is the main reason for selecting ECMO or deciding to put a patient on ECMO is your conventional mechanical ventilation is either unable to achieve sufficient oxygenation to meet the metabolic demands, or when you try to increase the ventilation, it may cause more injury like barotrauma, valvulotrauma and all those things without achieving the ultimate purpose of oxygenating the patient. If these two things happen, then the solution is only for going for this ECMO or the ECMO. Now, I think somebody came and did something. It's not working now. While the use of ECMO has defined indications in clinical practice, the removal of carbon dioxide is still not a, it's still under trial. It has not been proved. And so in patients who are hypercarbic, using ECMO for removal of CO2 is still in the trial stage, but is being investigated. Now, coming to the modes of ECMO, you mentioned only there are about two methods, what is called the veno-venous and the veno-arterial, which are the conventional ones which have been there for a long time. And veno-venous, as you all know, is mainly indicated in reversible respiratory failure. So it is not a permanent respiratory failure. Potentially reversible respiratory failure should be there before you decide to put the patient on veno-venous ECMO. And veno-arterial allows hemodynamic support mainly and is indicated for cardiac failure with or without respiratory failure. So if you put a patient on VA, it will support both the heart and to some extent the respiration. Whereas veno-venous ECMO is purely for potentially reversible respiratory failure. See, like that you must highlight the importance or points in your answer so that you don't have to be unnecessarily beating around the bush and unnecessarily wasting your time. Okay. So veno-venous ECMO is indicated for severe but potentially reversible respiratory failure, whereas veno-arterial ECMO allows hemodynamic support and is indicated mainly for cardiac failure, of course, with or without respiratory failure also. Then there is a third category, which I said about carbon dioxide removal. It is called AV ECMO, arteriovenous ECMO. And what is the difference between a VA ECMO and an AV ECMO? Just it is not the alphabets which are changed for position. Okay. VA ECMO requires a pump to circulate the blood, whereas AV ECMO depends on the patient's own arterial pressure, because we just want to remove the carbon dioxide, so which facilitates gas exchange, especially carbon dioxide removal, by using patient's own arterial pressure to pump the blood through the circuit. It doesn't require a centrifugal pump or other type of pump to push the blood. This AV ECMO is sometimes called as extracorporeal carbon dioxide removal system. So this is one new point at the need of the hour. Is you can include in this more than anything else. Now, coming to the current salvage interventions for refractory hypoxemia, what should you automatically first do is, after trying all these things only, you should go for ECMO. First is the optimization of fluid balance. Second is recruitment maneuvers. Third is the proning position. Fourth is the high flow oxygen. Then the airway pressure release ventilation. And then corticosteroids, sedation, and use of neuromuscular blocker. Then go for invasive ventilation, use of permissive hypoxemia, accepting lower saturations in the region of 70% with a PaO2 of 40 to 50, rather than using potentially injurious ventilatory techniques. So the initial correction should be identified by, I mean, tried by using these modalities. And then if that is not happening, then you go for the conventional, I mean, the ECMO treatment. And there are some exclusions which you have to know before you try to put the patient on ECMO. Those are the recommendation. The best survival rates in patients treated with ECMO are observed in respiratory failure due to non-necrotizing viral pneumonia, probably because these are often young patients with less comorbidity and the associated lung injury is often reversible. So these are the categories you should select. Patients should be younger in age group. They should not have much comorbidities. And you must have a potentially reversible lung injury. Then if these three criteria are met, then ECMO will be quite successful. So who are all the patients whom you should exclude from ECMO? Non-availability of a trained multidisciplinary team with access to specialized intensive care and cardiothoracic or vascular services. If it is not there, there should not be any ECMO attempt in that hospital. Pulmonary edema from myocardial dysfunction, unless ECMO is a holding measure before transplantation. So if it is a cardiomyopathy patient in failure and is waiting for a transplant, then you can go for ECMO. But if it is a direct myocardial dysfunction due to an acute myocardial failure or infarction, then ECMO has no role in that. And patient has acute myocarditis from which he or she is likely to recover. If that is the case, then you can go for ECMO. Then exacerbations of chronic obstructive pulmonary disease with respiratory failure, multiple organ failure from severe sepsis or SARS syndrome, pneumocystitis, pneumonia requiring ventilation, severe comorbid illnesses, which impact significantly on life expectancy like malignancy or terminal cancer and other serious chronic illnesses, and inadequate recruitment or diuresis or dialysis in the presence of fluid overload, and any condition that is potentially irreversible. If all these conditions are there, these patients are not fit for ECMO. You must exclude them. Of course, technical difficulty associated with the procedure and where systemic anticoagulation is contraindicated. For example, a patient already had a CVA and he has developed a respiratory problem and you can't put him on anticoagulation. He will develop a more severe bleeding, intracerebral or intracranial bleeding. Similarly, immunosuppression not likely to recover rapidly, and patients mechanically ventilated for more than 7 days as an underlying lung damage might be more severe, and patients age more than 75, all these things you should take into consideration and exclude those patients. Now, what are the specific indications for veno-venous ECMO is primary ARDS with refractory hypoxemia, severe pneumonia, particularly viral, like our present-day COVID, and any pneumonia without multiple organ failure. Without multi-organ failure, you should select. No pulmonary contusion, gas inhalation, aspiration, and smoke inhalation. All these things also you can take. And status asthmaticus or reversible airway obstruction, not able to be ventilated conventionally or rapidly ameliorated, and pulmonary embolism. These are the three indications that are given for specific indications for VV. And for VA ECMO, weaning from cardiopulmonary bypass after cardiac surgery, if it is going to be difficult, you can use it as a bridge to support the patient. And before cardiac transplant as a bridge therapy, and in acute myocarditis and pulmonary hypertension, following endarterectomy or surgery on the congenital heart defects. These are all the indications for veno atrial, which is mainly for cardiac support. Now, there is the simple line drawings or some at least a chamber type drawings you should be able to draw in the exam so that you can without wasting time where to insert, where to remove all these things. You can put these diagrams. Drawing this heart is not a very difficult thing. So venous ECMO can be a double stage single cannular approach. Okay, so you put a cannula which goes into the IJV, into the SVC, and then goes to the right atrium, and you can draw the blood from that, oxygenate, and then reperfuse again into the right atrium. Okay, so this is the venous blood is drawn out, oxygenated, and again it is put back into the right atrium after oxygenation, so that the lung, which is not able to do that job, it will only act as a conduit. Through the oxygenated blood will go through the pulmonary circulation and come to the left atrium, and it will be serving the body. Okay, so this is the first method, which is a single cannula approach. Then there is a two cannula approach again for venous, where you insert it into the venous blood is drawn from the femoral by passing the catheter up to the IVC or SVC. Okay, so you can see the dotted line going there. It is not just inserted only into the femoral, but it goes through the femoral almost up to the heart, and then it takes the blood, and then it is oxygenated, and then it is put back again into the artery very close to the right atrium. So instead of using as a single catheter lumen, you are using a two catheters which are going to, so it will go to the IJV, the return flow will go to the IJV, the drawing of blood will go through the, from the femoral it goes up to the IVC and then draws the blood. So that is about the two cannula system for venous. Then coming to veno arterial, again you draw the blood from the femoral, again it goes, it is not just the femoral or the iliac, it goes up to almost the IVC. Okay, so the blood is drawn from there, then it is oxygenated, then it is pushed back into the right atrium, femoral artery, up to the level of below the IVC. Okay, it is not just pumped into that. You may be thinking, what is the use of pumping the oxygenated blood into the femoral? It will go only to the lower limb. No, but the cannula goes into the IVC almost above the renal or sometimes below the renal, and then it serves most of the time the other half. There is a complication because of that, we will see what it is. And otherwise you can also take it from the femoral and then push back the thing directly into the aorta. Okay, so that also can be done. Then the third thing is you can, there is a third method where you can take it from the femoral and then again go through one of the subclavian or the brachial and then try to push it back into the heart and then go to the entire body. Now coming to the veno arterial ECMO cannulation approach, again there is a central method. These are all peripheral methods. You go from the femoral and then go into that. This is the central method cannulation, where you take the blood from the right atrium and then put it directly into the aorta back at the ascending level. Then what is the difference between veno arterial and veno venous extracorporeal membrane? You can put a tabular column like this so that it will be easy to enumerate. So in veno, VA ECMO provides cardiac support to assist circulation. Venous provide cardiac support to assist the respiratory system and mainly oxygenation. Requires arterial and venous cannulation, whereas VV requires only venous cannulation. Bypasses pulmonary circulation, decreases pulmonary artery pressures, and whereas the venous maintains pulmonary blood flow because everything is going through the right atrium, right ventricle like that. And it could be used in right ventricular failure. We know atrial can be used in RV failure, but it can be here, you cannot use it because it is going to go through the pulmonary circulation also. And low perfusion rates are needed here, whereas you require higher perfusion rates to maintain the oxygenation. In veno atrial, higher PaO2 is achieved, whereas here you are going to get only a lower PaO2 because it is going through the venous side and again going to have some venous admixture, and then so the PO2 naturally will be slightly lower. You are not pumping the entire oxygenated blood directly into the systemic circulation. And ECMO circuit connected in parallel to the heart and lungs, whereas the ECMO circuit is connected in series. That is, what do you mean by series is going through right atrium, right ventricle, pulmonary, coming to the left atrium. That is called the series. Whereas here it is going through the venous side separately and arterial side separately. Now, what are the complications of ECMO could be related to the underlying pathology which needed ECMO. So that complication can become more. For example, in a COVID patient, it is not only hypoxia, it could be other problems like renal, vascular in the cerebral or kidney, everywhere it can affect the whole process. Or the ECMO condition itself, surgical insertion, that is a technical problem, surgical insertion, circuit tubing, bending or collapsing, anticoagulation problems, and ECMO inserted for pulmonary support has less complications than ECMO inserted for cardiogenic, because you are going to go through both the artery and veins. So the chances of more complications are there for veno-atrial. And the worst outcomes are reported when ECMO is used after ECPR. Nowadays, one of the indications for cardiopulmonary response after your conventional compression and ventilation, if it is not revived, there is a technique called ECMO-assisted cardiopulmonary resuscitation, which is called ECPR. Okay? So, majority of the times, you just for namesake, you try, but the success rate is supposed to be very, very low with ECPR. But children have less complications than adults, except for neurological complications. The most frequent complication of ECMO is hemorrhage, because you are going to anticoagulate and you are cannulating all the major vessels. The most important problem is hemorrhage. And bleeding is increased because of systemic heparinization, platelet dysfunction, or other clotting factor hemodilution. And intracerebral hemorrhage or infarction is the most important complication. And one of the famous singers in Chennai last year, he died not because of ECMO, but because of cerebral hemorrhage, and they could not do anything about it. Coming to the medical complications, hypertension is a dangerous complication, and arrhythmias, this as a result of hypoxia and electrolyte imbalance or an underlying cardiac pathology. Oliguria, commonly observed as a renal complication during the early part of ECMO, when you try to take the blood out. And acute tubular necrosis also is seen in some cases, which may require hemofiltration or dialysis. Then they can develop GI tract complications like GI bleed, stress ulcers, ischemia, and bleeding tendencies. And direct hyperbilirubinemia and biliary calculi may occur, secondary to prolonged fasting and TPN, hemolysis and diuretics. And septic complications, naturally, any invasive procedure is always wrought with the septic complications, which may result in ECMO circuit representing a large intravascular foreign body, and frequent manipulation, all these things increase the risk of infection. The metabolic complications include electrolyte imbalance, hypo or hyperglycemia, and ECMO may alter serum concentration of drugs due to increased volume of distribution and decrease kidney or liver function. So caution is needed when you use therapeutic drugs, otherwise they may go in for a toxic level. And mechanical complications, clot in the circuit. If proper heparinization is done, plus there may be clot formation. And so nowadays we have heparin-coated ECMO systems, which are there to prevent this problem. And coming to the veno-arterial ECMO, specific complications are cannula-related, which can be vessel perforation with hemorrhage, arterial dissection, distal ischemia, or incorrect location, or development of pseudoaneurysm at the site of the insertion. Coming to cardiac thrombosis, occurs secondary to retrograde flow in the ascending aorta whenever peripheral cannulation through the femoral artery and vein are used for veno-arterial ECMO. Now, coronary and cerebral hypoxemia can occur due to VECMO, because fully saturated blood is infused peripherally into the femoral artery. That's what I said. One of the problems of going up to the only IVC is most of the oxygenated blood goes to the periphery. So ECMO circuit will preferentially perfuse lower extremities and the abdominal viscera. So the rest of the oxygenation for the upper part of the body is to be done by the heart itself. And to avoid this complication, arterial oxygen hemoglobin saturation should be monitored in both the upper extremity and lower extremity. Now there are some organ management required in ECMO patient. The aim of organ management is to avoid multi-organ failure in a patient who is suffering from primary failure of the heart and on lung or both. So before initiating ECMO, better understanding of the new hemodynamics and physiologic body responses to be understood. And hemodynamics play a major role in the outcome. And it can affect the cardiac system, respiratory system, renal, CNS, and hematology, and infection control are all very, very important. Okay? So these are the points that you have to remember about ECMO, which are, it's not a complete answer, but some points which you have to remember are to be given here. Okay?
Thank you, sir.
Righto. Who is
can
the next
one? To the next talk, sir?
Yeah.
Next will be Dr. Vikas Deswal from Garden Reach Hospital, Kolkata, South Eastern Railway. Thing on ketamine present status in anesthesia practice. Over to Dr. Vikas.
Good evening. Go ahead. I can hear you.
Sir, my topic. Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Ketamine is an dissociative anesthetic agent which acts both on the and in CNS it acts on NMDA receptor, opioid receptors, and monoaminergic receptors. In spinal cord, NMDA receptors, and it inhibits the which makes it very versatile. It has a very low protein binding ability, but it is dissolved in aqueous solutions and liquid and in lipids. So by that we have a lot of options of administering it. Administer from nasal route, oral route, sublingual, rectal, transdermocutaneous, intravascular, intramuscular, intraosseous, epidural, and intrathecal routes. And being so lipid soluble, it quickly reaches and the brain after crossing the blood-brain barrier. So there is rapid effects of analgesic due to ketamine occurs, and after metabolism, it is sir. It also acts on the sympathetic nervous system and provokes it, which increases the cardiac output, the blood pressure, the heart rate. And so it is this property makes it very useful in trauma patient where there is hemodynamic compromise, but a caution should be taken while there are ischemic heart disease. Sir, there are on respiratory system, it does not have much effect on the central respiratory system, but these of ketamine have also been identified. And they are neuroprotective, anti-inflammatory, anti-tumor, antioxidative. And while coming to their application in nowadays, it can be used in general anesthesia, both induction and maintenance. And it's a very secure induction agent in severe asthma, bronchial constriction, and refractory bronchospasm. And it has hemodynamic advantage over propofol and thiopental in patients where patient is very unstable hemodynamically, like in shock and hypotensive patients. And it is also used in cesarean where the patient has got very hypotensive and hypovolemic, like in uterine or in placental abruptio. And along with its hemodynamic effect, it also increases the uterine tone and the respiratory depression that these GAs cause in a neonate. So it has advantage in such cases. And as an alternative to etomidate, we can use for endotracheal intubation in severe sepsis, trauma like brain injury, cardiac tamponade, and restrictive pericarditis. And in pediatric patients where they're who are having congenital heart disease, where right to left shunt is present. So in such cases, we can use it. It increases the vascular resistance, it decreases the blood flow from right to left heart. So the dosage, we are not with the IV route, we go for IM, and that dosage 4 to 6 mg per kg. And for minutes, we use 0.5 to 1 mg per kg IV. If we are combining it with 50% nitrous oxide in oxygen, and in acute pain we can use it, and in acute pain it can be used in peri and post operative analgesia, because they decrease the opioid use and the complications of opioids like nausea, vomiting, constipation, and it decreases the overall the dosage of opioids in these patients. And in fracture, in extremities also, we can give analgesia in form of ketamine, and in burns and in severe pain in like in the wars and in accidental injuries, and in non-cancer chronic pain, it is efficacious in hyperalgesia and opioid tolerance, and in phantom limb pain, therapy resistant neuropathic pain, fibromyalgia, migraine, visceral pain, and in cancer pain, together with opioids, it improves the efficacy of cancer pain therapy, and it is also used in adjuvant analgesic in chronic cancer pains. And sedative, we can use it because it in pediatric patient who are undergoing procedures outside the operating room, and in short painful procedures in emergency department, and as an antidepressant we can use it in treatment resistant depression. And another good thing about this drug is it quickly induces depression, unlike other conventional antidepressants. The dose here would be around 0.2 to 0.8 mg per kg IV over 2 to 3 minutes. So this is all the uses that I found for which it is used nowadays.
Yeah, but you know how, when it was introduced and why, where it was very extensively used, any idea?
Sir, I didn't read that.
Read that, okay. It was actually used very much in the veterinary medicine. In veterinary practice, that is where ketamine was first introduced, and they were able to do a lot of procedures with animals using ketamine. Later on only, yes, they started using it in human beings also. So still there is a stigma that it is a veterinary medicine that is being used for mankind. Yes. And nowadays a lot of improvements have happened, and people are they were not previously what they were not aware of the good qualities or the usages of ketamine have now been discovered, and people are started using it not only as an anesthetic agent but also for other purposes. So I think I will show you a presentation which may give you an idea as to what it should be done about. Yes, that. Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Are you all able to see?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Visible.
So title is Ketamine Current Applications in Anesthesia, Pain and Critical. I think you have taken some of the points from the same article only. Anyway, the first thing is we just know a little bit of pharmacology of ketamine, which you have mentioned. It's a water-soluble phencyclidine derivatives, because in the exam, they may ask you which group of drug it belongs to. Mainly in the VIVA, when they give you a drug, they many times ask you, for first question the examiner may ask you is what group it belongs to. So it's a phencyclidine derivative, and it has got the present-day ketamine has got both the molecules of S and I isomers. So it is a racemic mixture of both isomers. And the other question they commonly ask you is, what is the IUPAC name? So International Union of Applied Chemistry. Now they have this is the name for that, 2-chlorophenyl, 2-methylamino, cyclohexane 1. So that is the name of the chemical compound. Actually, the chemical name of that is the name. And ketamine is highly lipid soluble and undergoes rapid breakdown and deep distribution in peripheral tissues. It is metabolized in the liver too by N-demethylation and ring hydroxylation pathways. And norketamine is the metabolic product. And that has got 1/3 to 1/5 of the efficacy of ketamine. So even the metabolic product or the metabolized product of ketamine can have some potency up to 1/5 or 1/3 of the original compound. And ketamine is excreted in urine and feces as norketamine and as hydroxylated derivatives. Now it has a cumulative effect. That is one point you have to remember. Whenever you give it as an infusion, that is why we give it nowadays, we are able to give it in a very, very low dosages to get a good effect, is because of this cumulative effect. But gradual resistance develops on repeated administration. It is not like tachyphylaxis, which you normally see with the other drugs, but over a period of time, if you use it for 3 days, 4 days as a continuous infusion, nowadays the recommended treatment for opioid addicts or opioid dependent patients is usage of ketamine in a low dose for pain relief as well as for counteracting this opioid-induced hyperalgesia, which I think we talked in an earlier class. So that is the main thing that we have to remember. But even used continuously for 3-4 days, gradually you may get a resistance and you may have to increase the dose. And coming to the pharmacodynamics, it stimulates the cardiovascular system, resulting in increase in heart rate, blood pressure, and increase in cardiac output, mediated principally by the sympathetic system stimulation. There is minimal effect on the central respiratory system. So however much you give, unlike opioids, it doesn't cause a respiratory depression. So it is free from any respiratory effect on the centrally acting. It neither depresses nor stimulates, but produces a very good airway relaxation of the smooth muscles, again by the sympathetic stimulation. And it has got anti-inflammatory effects, cascades into these muscles. But the only problem is it increases the salivary and the pharyngeal secretions and increases the muscle tone. And it has a cataleptic, amnestic, and analgesic property, which is dose-dependent anesthetic action. And the dissociative state produced by ketamine is unique, in which the patient appears awake, but it is detached from the surrounding. So, this drug makes you like a very well-read rishi, you know. He can be in a detached attachment state. He is in the world, but he is detached from everybody. So ketamine produces a state like that. And the mechanism of action is, it is a non-competitive antagonism to NMDA receptor. That is a very important point that all of you should remember, which is asked in the examination also. It's a non-competitive antagonism too. So however much you try to increase the level of glutamate in the body, you cannot compete with that. So it's a non-competitive antagonism, and it interacts with opioid receptors, monoamine, cholinergic, purinergic, adrenal receptor system as well, and having local anesthetic effect also. Now coming to the newly found mechanisms of action of the newer clinic and with the newer clinical application, this is what the question that has been asked is. So the NMDA receptor interaction with ketamine plays a role in the opioid-induced anti-hyperalgesia, and subanesthetic doses of ketamine via NMDA receptor block potentiate the opioid analgesia. Third thing is ketamine suppressing the induction of nitric oxide synthase activity and protein expression by endotoxin exerts a protective anti-inflammatory effect against sepsis. Third thing is hypnotic effect. Fourth thing is hypnotic effects of ketamine are caused by combination of channel blockade of NMDA and hyperpolarization activating the cation channel. So calcium also is pumped in, which is also important for the hypnotic effect. It has got anti-pro-inflammatory effects responsible for anti-hyperalgesic effects. The immediate analgesic effects are mediated by combination of opioid system sensitization and anti-nociception. And ketamine inhibits tumor necrosis factor alpha and interleukin 6 gene expression in macrophages. These are the two important inflammatory cytokines. So by inhibiting their expression, that is how its anti-inflammatory effect is mediated. So NMDA receptor blockade inhibits the extracellular signal related to kinase half pathway. So proliferation of cancer carcinoma cells also is arrested. So that is not only anti-inflammatory, but some anti-cancerous activity is also explained by this mechanism. And it has got an antidepressive depressant effect because of the post-drug effects of activity-induced structural synaptic connectivity. So in the brain, it acts as an antidepressant also by the at the neuromuscular at the neuronal junctions. Now coming to the well-established applications of ketamine, they are almost remaining unchallenged. An IV induction agent in emergency setting in shocked and hypotensive patients. Then for patients with reactive airway diseases, especially those with bronchospasm, this is the drug of choice. It is only not only an anesthetic agent for induction, it can also be used as a bronchodilator as a medical therapy. So in those days, one examiner used to ask the candidates, what is the medical indication for ketamine? All of us used to say it's only an anesthetic agent, but he used to ask what is the medical indication. So in status asthmaticus, which is not responding to the conventional anti-asthmatic treatments, ultimately you can try a small dose of ketamine, which will be very effective. Another drug which is also recommended in this situation is magnesium sulfate. So normally we try to give beta 2 agonists, but when those beta 2 agonists don't work, or the proteinuria and other drugs don't work, you have to remember two drugs. One is magnesium sulfate, another is ketamine, which is very useful in the ICU setting. The third thing is for induction in children with congenital heart disease, which point you mentioned. So you have to preserve the systemic vascular resistance to decrease the right to left shunt. So that is where the ketamine plays a major role, especially in tetralogy of Fallot. And burns is very important. Even today, burns treatment belongs mainly in ketamine. And widely used for providing analgesia for dressings during excision of and scar and grafting and for sedation. And I have told on the earlier PGs, there is a cocktail using ketamine for acute burns analgesia. That is 2 ml of ketamine, preservative free ketamine, which comes in ampules. Each ml containing 50 milligram. So you take 2 ml of that, which will be 100 milligrams of ketamine. You take 2 ml of tramadol, which is again 50 milligram per ml. So that will be 100 milligram tramadol. And you take that 1 ml midazolam, which contains 5 milligram of midazolam. So 2 plus 2 plus 1, totally 5 ml, which will contain 100 milligram ketamine, 100 milligram tramadol, and 5 milligram midazolam. This 5 ml volume is diluted with normal saline up to 50 ml by adding 45 ml of normal saline. So you get a total volume of 50 ml. So this 50 ml contains 100 milligram of ketamine, 100 milligram of tramadol, and 5 milligram of midazolam. So each ml will contain 2 milligram of ketamine, 2 milligram of tramadol, and 0.1 milligram of midazolam. This, if you give as a slow IV infusion of 1 to 2 ml per hour, that means this whole 50 ml volume can be utilized for 24 hours, almost 48 ml only will be utilized. That will produce an excellent analgesia for burns patients, especially superficial burns patients who have 30%, 40% superficial burns, which is very, very painful. Instead of giving or dumping them with too much of morphine or pethidine, this combination worked out very well. And if you want to do any dressing change or anything, you can rush another 3 or 4 ml extra and finish off the dressing within about 10 to 15 minutes without any discomfort of the patient. I have used it extensively in my practice because I was working with plastic surgeons, and it is really a boon to the patients, especially during the first 48 hours or 72 hours when the pain is very, very severe. So the combination is 2 ml of ketamine, 2 ml of tramadol, and 1 ml of midazolam, but that midazolam should contain 5 milligram. Okay, not that 1 milligram in usual 10 ml vial. And oral and IV ketamine have been used as analgesic and sedative for wound care procedures in children with burns, and provides improved analgesia and sedation. Then ketamine in combination of midazolam and dexmedetomidine provide effective sedoanalgesia. That is a newer terminology which has been used. So both sedation and analgesia will be offered. Then pre-hospital and battlefield medicine, where, for example, a building collapse or a mass casualty, where you want to retrieve patients who are buried under the debris, giving them one shot of ketamine IM makes them very comfortable when you try to evacuate them from that battlefield or the accident sites. And low dose ketamine, this is a mantra you should remember nowadays. Nowadays, we talk only about low dose ketamine, that is 5 to 25 milligram per minute for sedation and analgesia using local or regional anesthetic procedure. That's not milligram, that's microgram. Sorry, it's a typing mistake. So that is supposed to be very useful. And IV ketamine 0.5 can be given prophylactically before neuraxial blockade, which decreases the shivering, is very much reduced. Incidence of shivering is reduced if you give it well before you're doing a neuraxial, that is spinal or epidural. You just give 0.5 milligram per kg IV and then do the spinal, the post-spinal shivering is very much reduced. Now, IV ketamine 1 milligram can be given before spinal for elderly patients to provide good hemodynamic stability. And intermediate clinical applications, which are now currently used is in pediatrics for pre-medication, this can be done as 3 to 10 milligram intranasal, because another advantage with ketamine, it is you can apply it to any, through any part of the body, any route of the body. You can give it oral, you can give it intranasal, you can give it IM, IV, intrathecal, any route you know in pharmacology, every route can be used for administration of ketamine. That is another plus point for the drug. And because of its rapid action, it can be used as an IM induction also in children. And in my practice with the plastic surgeons, all congenital hand or even cleft lip and cleft palate, children who are liable for parental separation and anxiety, I always used to give them an intramuscular dose of 3 milligram per kg of ketamine, which is called the stunning dose, because intramuscular 10 milligram is supposed to be the anesthetic dose. So if you give 3 milligram per kg IM, it acts just to sedate the child without any resistance, and it won't know that it is being separated from the parent also. So that is a very useful technique by which you can bring in a child without crying or without making any fuss about. And you can secure an IV line easily without causing any much pain to the child also. So that I have been doing for a number of years in my practice without any complication. So it's a safe technique to follow. And it also prevents the postoperative delirium in children. So when you combine it with propofol, And sevoflurane usually causes emergence delirium or emergence agitation in pediatric patients. But a ketamine and propofol combination reduces this delirium. So patients come out nicely without any crying or any restlessness, and a good sedation and analgesia will be there. And for a long time, we have been adding ketamine to the caudal blocks in children to prolong the duration as well as the efficacy. Okay, so 0.5 to 1 milligram per kg of preservative-free ketamine you should add. You should not add the ketamine which is available in the vial. Multi-dose vials always have a preservative, whereas the 2 ml ampule ketamine is preservative-free. That you can always add to the local anesthetic and give it in the caudal, which is accepted, especially in the peripheral areas. It will be useful for a prolongation of the action of the local anesthetic also. And in IV area also, nowadays they are adding this again to make the patient tolerate the tourniquet for a longer time. And in stellate ganglion block, it produces a good prolongation for in the CRPS and other cases. It gives a good relief for a longer time. And again, as I said earlier, post-anesthetic shivering is reduced. So these are the intermediate clinical applications. Now coming to the recent clinical applications, procedural sedation for both adults and children. You can do some wound dressing, you can do an abscess IND. These are all called procedural sedation. So short procedures can be done under that. Then sedation and analgesia and critical care unit. So nowadays, where patients who are very agitated and restless on ventilator, you can use ketamine low dose for sedating, and it produces, because it gives good analgesia also, patients tolerate the tube well, the drain sites don't bother them, so that acts as a good sedation also. And it can be used as a co-induction and a total IV anesthesia. Co-induction in combination with propofol. You are nowadays having a combination called ketofol, which is a combination of ketamine and propofol. So the good effects of both combined together. Propofol normally causes a decrease in the blood pressure and reduction in the heart rate, whereas ketamine individually causes a tachycardia and hypertension. So when you combine both, you get a good hemodynamic stability. There is no drop in blood pressure. There is no excessive bradycardia or tachycardia. So both are nullified, and that combination is called a ketofol. And in acute pain management for perioperative analgesia, again, you take a low dose ketamine and give it as an IV infusion, and they can give it as a preemptive intranasal in children, especially for endoscopic and nasal surgery. I mean, first surgeries also they use it. And for laparoscopic cholecystectomy, it can be given as a preemptive analgesia. And again, it is given as a low dose for adjuvant to postoperative analgesia for exogenous opioid-induced hyperalgesia. And low-dose subcutaneous or IV can be given for post-tonsillectomy pain in children. And the ketamine, they have applied to the tonsillar fossa also after dissection, so that the pain evaluating from that is much reduced. And in the emergency department, low-dose ketamine is a very important drug which should be available. It can give as a infusion or IV. And instead of the commonly used opioids for pain management. So these are all the acute pain conditions. One is the as a preemptive analgesic, another is a postoperative analgesia, and third is the post-tonsillectomy, and in the emergency department. So in all acute pain conditions, you can use this. Coming to the chronic pain management, non-cancer pain, even though it is not officially allowed, people use it what is called the off-label use, administered both topically and intravenously in small subanesthetic doses as an analgesic for treating chronic painful condition. And he mentioned what are all the conditions like phantom pain, CRPS, all fibromyalgia, all these things are called non-cancer pain. The action of ketamine on opioid tolerance and hyperalgesia is well known, so it can you can avoid all that by giving ketamine to those patients. So these are all the conditions which which are called the non-cancerous painful conditions, which I mentioned earlier. And in cancer pain, ketamine is now considered as an essential adjuvant to refractory cancer pains. Coming to miscellaneous applications, nowadays they use it in cardiopulmonary bypass surgery also. A single dose of 0.5 milligram ketamine given upon induction is associated with lower serum levels of C-reactive protein and lower incidence of delirium and cognitive dysfunction after cardiopulmonary bypass. This is supposed to be due to the neuroprotective and anti-inflammatory effects of ketamine. Then along with dexmedetomidine, when you give it in infusion in scoliosis surgery, you can do the somatosensory evoke potentials without any patient discomfort or jerking or jumping, and adequate depth will be maintained. So you don't have to unnecessarily paralyze and wait for the effect to go on. So by giving this as an IV infusion as a TIVA, you can do that. And the same combination is recommended in the textbooks also for bariatric surgery in morbidly obese patients. So instead of using too much of volatile anesthetic agents, they have found the latest recommendation for obese patients undergoing bariatric weight reduction surgery procedures is to use a combination of dexmedetomidine and ketamine. And ketamine sedation during spinal anesthesia for arthroscopic knee surgery reduces the ischemic reperfusion problems. And in electroconvulsive therapy, previously we thought any drug which is going to stimulate the brain, you should not use. You should only use thiopentone or propofol. But the problem is they depress the brain. So eliciting a convulsion is very difficult if you use them in the regular anesthetic dose. And when you use it in the sub-anesthetic dose, it is inhumane. Patient will feel the effects of that convulsion. So by giving ketamine, you are taking care of both the problems. You are not suppressing the pain, so brain is easily stimulatable to produce a convulsion. At the same time, it prevents the patient from going in for the ill effects of the convulsion that is going to be caused. So nowadays they recommend it for ECT also. And ketamine gargles are now used for sore throat. And ketamine in small doses improves the postoperative depressive state in patients who have already been mentally depressed and symptomatic. Probably this is the reason why nowadays youngsters are all taking it as a recreation drug or a party drug. You know, probably it gets them out of that depression. And a famous thing has been going on with the bacha being kid has been arrested for all this problem, and all Bombay people you will be knowing. Symptomatic improvement possibly by inhibition of neuroinflammation in the spinal cord in restless leg syndrome, and intrathecal administration of preservative-free ketamine is a very, very wonderful method of giving anesthesia for any procedure in the body anywhere, up to 45 minutes. I have used it extensively earlier in my career for high-risk patients. Anywhere in the body you can operate. You can even do tonsillectomy or thyroidectomy if the surgeon is fast by giving intrathecal ketamine. Okay. And lastly, there is in patients even with liver damage and acute intermittent porphyria where thiopentone is contraindicated, our patients in hiccough, this works wonderfully. Okay. And the limitations and warnings of this ketamine are it increases the muscle tone. So it produces, it's not fit for conditions where you need a lot of relaxation, especially putting a lithotomy for gynecological procedures after ketamine is little tough, unless you combine it with a stiff dose of midazolam or dexmedetomidine. Ketamine alone will not allow the patient to relax to position them. And it is not indicated in conditions of hypertension, schizophrenia, raised ICP. Though it maintains the airway, there may be a problem because of the secretions. So it may produce a laryngospasm or irritability. And the psychological manifestation. So earlier it was not a very recommended drug because of this emergence of delirium. especially in young females, it used to be a problematic thing because they used to blabber some things for at least 1 to 2 hours. And earlier, it, as I told, it was used in the veterinary department for their animal surf procedures. So it still carries that same stigma that it can be a veterinary medication. And it has a potential for addiction. That is why nowadays people are illegally taking drug, and you see in the papers people are arrested for possessing ketamine in their custody. Ulcerative cystitis, secondary renal damage and hepatic failure can happen if high doses of oral ketamine are taken. And ketamine abuse can be affect the long-standing memory. And anesthetic concentrations of ketamine could exert antagonistic action both on mu and kappa opioid receptors, and hence high doses of ketamine may not be an appropriate addition to opioids. That is why you always give low dose after knowing this particular problem. If you give high dose, it blocks the opioid receptors instead of producing good analgesia. And epidural and spinal roots are generally not recommended due to unclear toxicity, but we have done a lot of cases without any issues. High dose ketamine accentuates apoptosis in the newborn of the brain of animals. Release of neurotoxic mediators may cause neuronal apoptosis, consequent to neuronal damage in humans. So these are all the newer things that are being talked about. So I think I will close that there. Sharing. Right.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Right. So we have time for the next question. It's like a huge topic already.
Yes, sir.
People are hungry. What shall we do?
9:30, sir.
We are
having one more topic also, but Mubin
could. That's quite a huge one. So shall we say good night here and go take it next class?
Yes, sir. So can we discuss this two questions in the next session, sir?
Whatever we are missing today, we'll postpone it to the next class. Because you know, already it is almost 6:30 to 9:30. Yeah. So
for the next session, can we have only these two topics, sir? Kidney and liver. They are huge topics.
Yeah. Then we can plan it that way. Yeah. It will take each one hour we have to discuss. Yes.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir.
Okay.
Thank you very much, sir.
Right. Any questions? Any doubts from the students? Everything clear as usual. Okay. Pratik Shukla, no questions?
Sir, Dr. Rakesh? Yes, sir. Good evening, sir.
Good evening, Pratik.
Sir, I was just having a doubt regarding ketamine abuse.
Ketamine abuse, yes. Addiction potential, no? All the opioids or any drug which interferes with your neurological system, over a period of time, you are likely to develop an addiction potential. You know how alcohol addiction happens? Any idea? You know, some people get so madly addicted to alcohol that without taking a gulp, as soon as they get up in the morning until they go to bed, they crave for alcohol, no? Have you seen alcohol addicts like that?
Yes, sir.
So if they don't drink every 2 hours or 3 hours, their hands will start trembling and they will start
physical dependence.
It's difficult to control them. They will have aggressive behavior. They will come and ask the money from the delirium tremens. All these things, withdrawal syndromes will happen. You know how it has been explained that when the alcohol gets metabolized in the body, it goes through a pathway called alcohol dehydrogenase pathway.
Yes, sir.
Okay? So that one of the byproducts combines with dopamine and forms a newer compound called tercaline. Okay? That compound only creates this sort of addiction. So that is the one which keeps on stimulating the brain to ask for more and more of alcohol. Okay. So for any addiction, there is always mechanism like that. Whatever drug you are taking, the metabolite combines with body's endogenous transmitters and produces a newer variety of compound which goes on stimulating the nerves and tries to get ask for more and more of that same compound.
Create the craving for the drug.
Craving for that is how the all the addiction problems happen. So the drug getting metabolized, the metabolite combining with a natural endogenous transmitter producing a new compound with a different action, which is the responsibility which causes this repeated usages or need, I mean, craving for that particular substance. So that is how the addiction comes. And even people, I have seen people are getting addicted to nitrous oxide also. We had one of our senior anesthetists in those days when I was a PG. After everybody quits the theater, he will open the nitrous oxide, inhale, and then he will start laughing. He used to enjoy with that, and then
without
we found
oxygen,
out.
Without oxygen.
It was an easy way to, without spending money, you know, to enjoy and get a stimulation. So I have seen people like that also. So all drugs like that, they have a potential for such actions.
Sir. And sir, how this alcohol, it causes the reduction in surfactant, sir?
How?
This alcohol, it causes reduction in surfactant in the lungs, no, sir?
Alcohol. So alcohol, you know, whenever a patient takes a lot of alcohol, the aldehyde, that metabolite compound, not only has an effect on the brain, but also on all the tissues. It acts as an inflammatory mediator.
Okay.
So that is the way the liver gets inflamed, the nervous system gets inflamed, the respiratory system gets inflamed. And in addition to that, when patients consume too much of alcohol, there is a what is called microaspiration taking place. Without their knowledge, they can quietly aspirate and they don't get a violent cough or anything. Microaspirates go into the lung and they also stimulate the inflammatory system, and then that also reduces the pneumocyte activity, and that also causes reduction in the production of surfactant.
One more thing, sir, you were telling about the intrathecal use of ketamine. For this tonsil surgery, sir.
No, that means it acts on the entire body. That's what I meant. Okay, but opening the mouth will be a little difficult.
Yes.
You can do any surgery because
absorbed from there and it causes systemic analgesia.
Yeah, after about 45 minutes, it will slowly come into the circulation and patients will have a little bit of. So, earlier what happened, I first tried it in one case of below knee amputation in a very sick patient who was a diabetic.
Yes.
So that was the time there was a publication in the journal that intrathecal preservative free ketamine is a very good analgesic without motor blockade or this thing. It gives very good analgesia for surgeries. So I tried it in one case of a very sick patient with a very low BP and it was tachypneic, acidotic and all these things. So leaving like that, he is anyway going to die. So I thought I will just try this and I gave 2 cc of ketamine intrathecally. And for to my utter surprise, surgeons were able to finish off the amputation within about 45 minutes time. And there was a dramatic improvement in the patient's condition once the septic source was removed. His sugars came down, his electrolyte imbalance got settled, his acidotic state became corrected. And the very next day, patient was happily sitting in the bed and talking to me. Because he was hardly about 54, 55 with a severe history of uncontrolled diabetes. Then I had one doctor patient who had multiple neurofibromatosis all over the body, but he had a tracheal stricture and he had a tracheal stent in situ. And so all the hospitals refused to give him GA because of the tracheal stenting and all that. And he had very painful lumps all over the body, and he was a doctor himself. So he came to the surgeon who was his classmate, and the surgeon asked me, what are you going to do? We have to somehow get him out of this pain. So again, I tried intrathecal ketamine, and he had three lumps in the chest, two in the groin, four in the leg, like that. So two, three teams of surgeons simultaneously operated all these things and removed the whole lumps. And patient was very comfortable. He didn't have any pain. And when he woke up, he said, have you finished the surgery? And he didn't luckily have much of delirium also, because I had given some IV midazolam and that took care of that. So like that, I have done more than about 10 to 20 cases. But long-term follow-up was not there, so I don't know whether any... Of course, if there had been any neurological sequelae, I would have come to know about it. But nothing has come far so far to my knowledge.
We will search the literature. It's very good news, I think, sir.
Pardon?
We will search the literature. I think it can be a very good use.
Yes, yes.
Sir, one more thing, sir.
Normally, sir, one just short question. Normally, this ketamine, it increases the intracranial pressure. But nowadays, patients suffering from head injury, it is said that...
I forgot to mention that. It is a traumatic brain injury. Because in traumatic brain injury, the main reason is they have identified the pathophysiology now. Previously, we were worried only about the ICP. But now what happens, there are three zones in brain injury. First is the central necrotic zone. Second is the what is called the penumbra. Third is the normal zone. So the, histologically, if you see when there is a brain injury, there is one area of total necrosis, there is no blood supply at all. Surrounding that, there is another area which is called the penumbra, which is receiving half supply and waiting. If perfusion is improved, it will survive. Otherwise, it will also start necrosing, necrotizing. And the third one is the normal zone. So by to make it normal, you have to keep the pressures high. So that is achieved by low doses of ketamine. So that is how the use of ketamine in traumatic brain injury has come to be a part of the treatment. So
Thank you, sir.
Also. Okay.
Is there any literature on inhalational ketamine, sir? Nebulized?
Nebulized ketamine, I have no idea. I have not heard of that.
Yes, it acts on...
Nasal only they give, but it doesn't act on the... I have not heard of it being inhaled up to down to the lower respiratory tract, and what is the effect. Whether it has a direct bronchodilator, I don't know. Maybe it's a topic worth taking up as a study or something like that. Because when you can put it on the nose, inside the nose, you can as well inhale it. Nothing is going to happen further. So yes, you can use a preservative-free ketamine for inhalation and see whether it will release the bronchospasm.
Yes, sir. Because pediatric airway strider after post-op extubation.
No, the strider, if it is a laryngospasm, we normally spray epinephrine, the nebulizer or a direct spray. But for bronchospasm only, ketamine will be useful, because it has not been proved to be useful in laryngospasm. In fact, it can cause laryngospasm if there are a lot of salivary secretions, and because the reflexes are preserved there.
Yes, sir.
But in bronchospasm, it causes smooth muscle relaxation. That is a different area. Okay, thank you.
Any more questions? Good night, sir.
Good night. Have a good weekend. Thank you so much. Thank you for your patient listening.
With all your permission, I'll sign off this meeting, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.